issues crushing. Turn like 0 degrees. I'm out the cage, gotta let out the beast. Revolutionary guy, let out the streets. Locked in a cage, I'ma let out the.
Let out the. Let out the.
Wake up, get out the sheets. We came for one man, forget my peace. You take the west, I take on the east. I'ma put him in a cage, never let out the.
Let out the. Let out the.
Yeah. I hear him trapped in the noise. Move too quick, can't stop for the talking. I hear him trapped with the boys. Not so tough, but man's keep walking, yeah. Just too sharp with the prize. Fight girls, better tell me I'm awesome, yeah. Hot like fire on the pan. If you wanna touch my please use caution.
Stop that. Stop that. Stop that.
One of my favorite stations on satellite radio is 90s on 9, which is now a classic station for all intents and purposes. But the only reason I bring it up is because even though my heyday is ancient, the idea that this weekend the Yankees are in first place, the Knicks are a 2 seed, we're talking about Conan O'Brien and O.J. Simpson and Saturday Night Live. And I'm like, this is the 90s.
It's the 90s are back.
The 90s over the weekend. I really enjoyed the number of people who seemed to be kind of discovering Conan O'Brien. I don't know how some of this stuff happens, where it is that you age out on things, and there's a whole generation, Stu Gatz, that has no access to Conan O'Brien being on mainstream television because... And that guy makes nothing but good things. Everything that he puts his name on is good. He's got a Max show. I could make the argument that he is as good as any late night show host ever, that they have all since desecrated it since he left, but that he was as good as anybody. And now he's getting a lot of love because of his Hot Ones appearance, where he just dedicated himself to the idea of comedy. Put it on the poll, please, Juju, at Lebatard Show. More famous Conan, the comedian or the barbarian?
Wow. Great question.
Izzy Gutierrez is here, and I'm happy about this because this is the loudest day that I can remember around the Knicks since that one playoff game they won against the LeBron, Wade, Bosh, Heat, and confetti fell from the ceiling. They won 50 games, which everyone in town in Miami makes fun of winning 50 games, but it's a big deal that New York has won 50 games, and they sneak into the 2 seed because DeMar DeRozan can't hit a shot late. One of the best clutch players in the league couldn't hit a shot late in Madison Square Garden.
I love that Knicks fans were actually having the argument of what seed they wanted to have. They didn't want the 2 seed. They wanted the 3 seed. They wanted the 4 seed. They should have lost that game. It was a bad win in overtime at home. You know what? There was a basketball game being played, and Tom Thibodeau wanted to win that basketball game. He does not care. And I love that about Thibs, but I'll probably blast him 5 games from now.
You won't like it in 6 games because Sixers and Heat are both bad matchups for the Knicks.
This is what I love about Stu. I have not heard Stu give a passionate Knicks take in years, and the first one he offers is they should have lost that game.
I didn't say
it's
that.
Amazing. Oh.
I didn't say it. I said I have a coach and a player in Brunson that doesn't want to lose that game. They want to win that game. They want the 2 seed. They don't care who they play.
Okay, they may.
They might in 5 games, though.
They might want to win the game, but DeRozan was shooting for the game at the end, no matter how much they wanted to win it. One of the things that I wanted to point out, Izzy, what do you do with this? Because the Miami Heat have been an unusual team all year. And on the road, they're one of the best teams in the league. They're 24-17 on the road. That's what Denver is, Stu Gatz. That's what OKC is.
Mm-hmm.
Boston's a little bit better than that on the road. They've got an enormous game against Philadelphia. You want to win that game and play the 2 seed. You do not want to play Boston first. They're not going to be afraid of Boston, but you don't want to play Boston first.
I'm a little nervous, Dan. Wow. Jeremy just smacked his hands together, Mr. Miyagi style. He's very excited about me being here as his ally, which
finally.
I'm very happy to be his ally, but that's
Why?
Not the vibe that I want right now, Jeremy, because this is not really
this
time
is not Birdman
for the Miami
time.
Heat yet. Okay, it is not that time yet. Like, the idea that this team can recreate that, first of all, they're begging. They're dying for that 7 seed. They do not want to face Boston in the first round and be their first victim. They will probably get swept. I'm going to say that right now if they face them in the first round. But if you suddenly fall to 2, or fall to 7, rather, and face the Knicks,
mm-hmm.
I mean, this whole idea, I've been talking about this recently, like the NBA has changed. You don't have two or three championship contenders anymore. You have several, and they sort of treat the regular season a little NHL style, where it's like, we don't care where we finish. We got a great coach. We got players. This is what we're going to do in a seven-game series. They feel like they have a chance. And I think it's not just the Miami Heat. It's a lot of these teams. It's all of these teams that don't really worry about their seeding except for, you know, Stugatz's Knicks there. So I do think right. that the Heat have an opportunity to repeat that. But the funny thing is everybody points to playoff Jimmy. After playoff Jimmy does what he does every single year, what do we say? Get him a little more help because he needs a little bit. They've gotten him more help, offensively anyway, than they ever have. And so if they're going to do what they did last year, it's kind of less of a surprise because he has more help around him now.
I don't think that Milwaukee minds that such a big deal is being made of the fact that the Knicks climbed up to 50 wins in the two seed and quietly Doc Rivers gets to sneak in as a three seed. How do you finish third? How do you finish behind the Knicks if you're the Milwaukee Bucks adding Damian Lillard?
Well, Giannis is hurt.
No, but this is just the last couple of games. He hasn't been hurt all season. It's just the last couple of games that he's been hurt. And he played the five before that that they lost to bad teams before he got hurt.
And now he's going to play, the Bucks are going to play the Indiana Pacers team that, if you remember, during the regular season kind of owned them. Tyrese Halliburton kind of felt like it was, you know, his show against that team. I consider him, I think I said this at some point, he is the more impactful superstar than Damian Lillard right now, Tyrese Halliburton. And now they've got to face them in the first round. Like, that's scary for Milwaukee. And, you know, Doc Rivers is getting everything everybody wanted to see him.
A little spin for you, Dan. A team letting go of their head coach midway through the season, getting the three seed. Kind of impressive, if you look at it that way.
What are you laughing about, Tony?
Because we're missing something here, and I don't want to stoke the Knicks Heat fire, even though I do. But I want to say something, and I think we're supposed to have a conversation about Jalen Brunson. Jalen Brunson's one of the best players in the NBA.
Correct. He is.
Like,
yes.
Have you seen his stats the last month? 34, 42, 45, 61, 30, 45, 43, 40, 39, 40. Like, he's an incredible player.
Preach.
More impressive.
Is that the
than
conversation?
That.
No, the conversation is the conversation is he's one of the best players in the East, now leading a Knicks team to Dan's 90s point. Feels like the 90s again. The Knicks are the two seed in the entire conference.
And we're talking about OJ again. Feel like the 90s.
Yep. You know, we are back, by the way.
The best compliment I can give to Jalen Brunson is that my boyfriend's made me watch a lot of Knicks games in the last 5 years we've been dating. And for the first time, I actually don't hate it.
Wow.
The question that I pose, the conversation I want to have is, if the Heat do end up getting out of the playoff, the play-ins, and it's Knicks Heat, 2-7.
Why do you sound like this? Is it from yelling?
Oh, it's been a long day.
It's yelling. What do you mean?
We just started.
What do you mean it's been a long day?
Masters weekend, Dan.
Excuse me. We had a lot of Tony Tonight's that we were filming last week. I was in the back end of a little bit of a cold. And then Saturday night, I mean, UFC 300, biggest card on the planet, biggest night for MMA ever. We were screaming. We had a live show at Grails presented by Cuervo. So we were screaming there. It was a big night. A
lot of screaming.
Excuse me. Big night.
Damn, when your week ends, Tony's begins.
Attaboy. I mean,
yeah.
That's right.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we do around here. Mm-hmm. But what I want to have, the conversation I want to have, Dan, is, are we sure that the best player in a Knicks Heat series is Jimmy Butler?
Jalen Brunson will not get the reputation that you wish for him to have until he starts winning playoff series. He is better than anybody thought he was. Better than, I think, the Knicks thought he was. Better than Dallas thought he was.
Well,
better,
they got rid of him.
Better than any. Yeah, they got rid of him, but at the time they got rid of him, next to nobody was saying that that was a disaster. And with Kyrie Irving replacing his usage rate, they're still pretty good, and I'd say better than the Knicks.
The funny part about the Jalen-Jimmy conversation is that it's the same one for each player, right? Nobody thought Jimmy Butler was a player who could lead the Heat to the type of success that they've had.
But he's done it.
Now he's done it.
Right.
Jalen Brunson is kind of the next guy of that mold that has led a team beyond where anyone anticipated. But thus far, it's just in the regular season. With Jimmy Butler in the Heat, it's been they've been just about an average team in the conference over the last several years. They got to the finals as a 5 seed. They got to the finals as an 8 seed. The aberration was the 1 year that
it's
they
not,
were the 1 seed.
It's not just that the players don't find the regular season to be worthy of their time. You will not have any kind of legacy based on anything he's done this season. And I'm just as awed by him as you are, but the way that Damian Lillard got the reputation that he did was shots in the playoffs. When you're playing these games that are regional games to a lot of people, they don't pay attention during the regular season. Basketball heads absolutely have no confusion about how good Jalen Brunson is, but now is the time for everybody to discover it because a whole lot of people are going to be tuning in for the first time to see what he can do at the end of games when his team is going to be overmatched. His team is going, like, if they have to play Philadelphia, that's a disaster, Stugatz.
Philly will be the favorites, I think.
I mean, outside of Boston, they can't have a worse match. Matchup. They don't want that to start because they don't have the best player on the floor.
Especially when you consider the size situation. And that, to me, is what's remarkable about Jalen Brunson. Look at this league. By the way, this sentence that I'm about to say shocked me when I heard it yesterday. It's this is the worst Victor Wembanyama is going to look for his entire career.
Did he scored 17 points in 3 minutes the other day?
Yes. And so the league is turning into aliens at every position. Look at Amen Thompson with the Rockets. He's going to be a point guard, and that guy's a ridiculous athlete.
Halliburton,
look what Jalen Brunson is doing at 6 feet tall. The amount of skill required to keep schooling these guys who are longer and more athletic than him and continuously doing it. The problem is, again, in a 7-game series where you're talking about size and you can sort of intimidate him. You can affect him more so than you can, let's say, Shai Gilgeous-Alexander, who does a lot of the same things. Gets to his spot, finds a way to get a shot off, and or maybe gets fouled. Longer, more athletic than Jalen. And so at some point, the answer's or the question's always going to be, is he big enough? Does he have that ability for 3-4 playoff series to take over at his size? And that's the question. I don't think the answer is yes.
We have a lot of we have sample sizes of smaller guys leading teams to through the playoffs to the NBA finals. I mean, he's not Allen Iverson, but the same questions were posed of Allen Iverson. He's 6 feet tall. How can he lead a team, be a number one on a team, and take him to the finals? Obviously, we know what happened when he got there and when he got to be in the playoffs, but it feels like that archetype is now it's almost like the small quarterback. Where there was a moment like, wait a second, I think we can put a guy who's like 5'10 back there and he can kind of make something happen. It feels like we're seeing that now, like almost a resurgence of point guards being a little bit smaller, maybe making something happen.
We know the matchup issue that obviously exists with the Sixers against the Knicks. The Sixers are overwhelming. You could argue they're the second best team in the conference because when Embiid is healthy, they've been dominant. For the Heat against the Knicks, the interesting part is this year's roster is actually better situated to guard Jalen Brunson than last year's team because you saw a lot of minutes from Max Strus and Gabe Vincent, who really struggled to guard Jalen Brunson. This year, there's a lot of long wings that play on that team. Terry Rozier is actually, as a guard, longer than what you had in Gabe Vincent. And the last time that the Knicks and the Heat played this regular season when they were scheming for Jalen Brunson, he was 5 of 18 from the floor for just 20 points. That's the worst game he's had over this last stretch.
Yeah, he wasn't very good. Tony's saying, I don't think this is a resurgence, though. A player of this size hasn't won the championship since what? Isaiah Thomas? Like, when is a player of this size doesn't get to win the championship? It's not a
wasn't Chris Paul, that's for sure.
It's not a thing.
At 6'2", I mean, there's not many.
I mean, 6'3", Dwayne.
You guys are forgetting, though, that Jalen Brunson, you can't measure heart. I mean.
Exactly.
Thank you, Steve.
I feel like you can.
Thank you.
I feel like
I mean, technically you can. You're right.
I feel like I can not only measure heart, I can then put it next to a 7-footer, and that heart can look really small.
Well,
that might not be a good thing.
They've got a bigger heart, though. The 7-footer's got a bigger heart naturally.
And large hearts are actually worse.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
On a medium-sized heart.
Well, so now, what are you?
Small
alleging?
Heart. Yeah.
Not small, but like
what are you
medium.
Alleging? You're alleging an enlarged heart?
No, not enlarging anything. I don't know.
You mentioned small, and I want to play for you guys the video here that I found fairly startling. It was universally mocked. Allen Iverson got a statue different than all the other statues that you've ever seen. I just don't think that by definition, because of its size, it qualifies as a statue. I think it has to be a trophy, not a statue. It doesn't seem like, I don't know what the height of a statue has to be to qualify as a statue, but if it's half the size of Allen Iverson, is it indeed a statue?
That goes on a coffee table. That's not a statue.
Yeah, that's a statuette, I believe. Ooh. Like, it's a small, that's a Degas. That's not a Rodin.
Well, what is the size of a statuette? What is the delineation that we're making between the size of a statue and statue? I don't know. Put it on the poll here, Juju, at Lebatard Show. Do you know the size difference between a statuette and a statue? Because maybe this is a statuette. This was the only one, correct? It wasn't like there were a bunch of these and this was the smallest one. They said, we've got an Allen Iverson statue and then it looks like a toy soldier.
I think that all the statues in that area are the same size, but lacking that context, you see it. It looks almost like when they're making a building and they have the model of the building, and you're like, like, you know, the Zoolander, like, how are we going to fit all these people in this building, whatever.
Center for ants.
Exactly, right. Hmm. It looks like that. Like, that's the finished
it's
product?
It's a model, yeah.
They say that statuette is small enough to stand on a table or shelf, and this is quite literally small enough to be on a table.
You think Iverson's offended by that? Like, he's smiling, he's selling it, he's selling that he's happy, it means a lot to him, but he's offended, right? I mean...
He didn't look offended.
Well, he's selling it. I mean,
where are they putting this in the facility? Because, like, when I think of statue, I think of the Michael Jordan statue outside of the United Center. Like, that is.
I think of Rocky.
Yeah, that too.
Good statue.
That's a statue.
That's a statue.
Imagine if the Rocky statue was this size, though.
No one's asking for the Lincoln Memorial here. All right, but it's a little small.
Out of curiosity, Stu Gatz, Allen Iverson strikes you as the type who just goes along with things organizationally. Like, fakes it a lot, that Allen Iverson
matured, Dan.
That shows fake enthusiasm for inauthentic things, you believe? I think
if he didn't like it, he would have said something, right?
I just think of him as being one of the more authentic athletes, most him or herself of all athletes. And so, given the amount of trouble that he had in general with Philadelphia management, and given that they don't give many statues in general in Philadelphia, are there across the sports teams, all of them? Are there five statues across all the sports teams?
Nick Foles has a big statue in Philadelphia.
What?
I mean, Super Bowl MVP.
What? He does, yeah.
Where?
It's the Philly special statue. I don't know exactly where it is. I assume it's near the stadium, though.
This one was so bad because they took... like the most iconic Allen Iverson moment, either this one or the step over, right? And he did it against Michael Jordan, and then you turned it into this little tiny doll where I'm like, imagine Michael Jordan looking at that thing and just kicking it over and being like, ha, I can't believe he got me with that move. But
I wonder
so
how
tiny.
Many people remember the fact that in his debut at the top of the key against Michael Jordan and what was supposed to be signaling something of a changing of the guard, he crossed over Michael trying to guard him while clearly traveling.
Stop that.
Clearly carrying the ball.
Did you see what Izzy was doing? He said it was a palm. It was not a palm.
How he was able to do that to Michael Jordan. Yes. Wait a minute. So that's not just a Nick Foles statue. That's also the Doug Peterson statue as well.
The Philly special,
when did they make that?
Well, he it,
Doug
yeah.
Peterson has a statue bigger than Allen Iverson.
And Nick Foles.
I think we can narrow it down to within the last 5 years, probably.
I don't remember them saying anything about, hey, we're building a statue for Nick Foles and Doug Peterson.
There's a lot of baseball statues in Philly, Dan. A lot of baseball.
There have been conversations in Philadelphia about replacing the Rocky statue with a statue of Jason Kelce. That is blasphemy. I'm sorry.
He's definitely getting a statue. I mean,
he's getting a statue, but not to replace the Rocky statue.
Could never replace the Rocky statue.
It's going to be bigger than, you know, actual size. It's going to be like the opposite of the Allen Iverson one. They're going to make it like
two times as big.
Three times as big.
His statue has to be the costume from the Super Bowl parade, right? Ooh.
Shirtless in a suite. Shirtless in a suite.
No, not shirtless. No.
Shirtless with, they should use actual human hair on the belly.
It becomes expensive at that point. Then. Come on,
that's actually a good idea.
It becomes expensive at that point.
Yeah, at that point. Yeah. Come on.
You know how there are statues where it's like good luck to rub part of it? Like the Lincoln statue in Springfield, Illinois. Apparently, it's good luck to rub his nose. So his nose is like copper. Yeah. And like, people have been rubbing it so like the finishes come off. We were in Ireland and we saw a statue of this woman with like the biggest boobs you've ever seen. And people, I think, touched the boobs because they were like a different color.
How many baseball players do they do in Philadelphia? Steve Carlton, Mike Schmidt, do they have a bunch of others? Like, who are the other Phillies that would be?
Mike Schmidt has a statue. I'm not certain if Lefty does.
Steve Carlton won 300 games and doesn't have a statue?
He's got it out.
He's got a statue.
He does.
I thought of Stugatz yesterday when that guy caught the Manny, that Dodger fan caught the Manny Machado home run ball and then did the old switcheroo and threw a different baseball on the field.
How did they find that, the boob statue? Yeah, so.
The internet is amazing that way, Jessica.
Way to go, video.
You'll find anything.
Oh, it's so fast.
You don't think Lewis has boobs always on his screen?
Definitely a tab open.
You don't think there's just a tab open of statue boobs? Statueboobs.com.
I think he just knows the public art in Dublin very well.
He's like
statueboobs.com.
He makes it like art but make it sports, but he art but make it boobs. Is that what Lewis does?
Best year for boob statues ever, Dan.
Stugatz, how do you feel about
Lefty has a statue, Dana?
I know, Jessica okay. just mentioned that.
Well, I was
that.
Just confirming it. So does Connie Mack.
Connie Mack.
The manager.
Oh. No news on nails yet, though. Checking it out.
Joe
Lenny.
Frazier.
You can't give Lenny Dykstra a statue.
Well, I mean, it's their city. Their Crucky? Statues. Yeah.
Crucky's has to have a cigarette in his mouth.
Crucky should have one by, like, that big Reading, whatever it's called, the food court.
Ready Market.
The famous Crucky story is just a woman coming up to him at a party with a cigarette and going, "You shouldn't be smoking. You're an athlete." He says, "I'm not an athlete. I'm a baseball player."
Baseball players should be fat again.
Yeah. It's Kenny Powers. That's what that line is for. It's such a great Kenny Powers.
Kenny
line.
Powers is actually based on John Rocker. John Rocker, racist John Rocker is the Kenny Powers, got the Kenny Powers treatment. But we've gone somehow 23 minutes without talking about Stugatz's beloved Masters, and it would appear that your boy Scotty Scheffler is better than everybody by a good amount. Like, you guys were telling me for so long, it's going to be Rory, it's going to be Sergio, all of these young people, and it's not. It's this guy.
Well, he's young, although he doesn't look young. He's 27. He looks like he's 37, maybe 47. But he was, Dan, it was Tiger-like from this standpoint. He's not Tiger. People are making that comparison. They're talking about, is this guy going to be better than Tiger?
He's a bad putter, correct? He's extraordinary at ball striking, but terrible at putting.
He's an improved putter. He's gotten better at putting. Where he is the best at, and perhaps the best I've ever seen, is tee to green. He is always on the green in regulation, which means he's putting for birdie and most likely getting a par if the birdie putt doesn't go in. But to have two Masters, to have two green jackets at the age of 27, to finish second, I believe, at the U.S. Open, the Open Championship, and the PGA Championship, to have all the victories that he has, he is certainly on track to being one of the all-time great golfers. It's very impressive because to win that tournament, when you're the overwhelming favorite to win that tournament and actually go out and do it and win it the way he did, man, that is Tiger-like.
Do I have this wrong, though? Because for 10 years, it feels like you guys have been trying to sell me on the latest new guy who's going to be the special thing.
Yes.
And this is not the guy people were talking about.
No, no.
It was Jordan Spieth. It was Brooks Koepka. They had their separate runs that looked kind of like this. It feels like Scottie Scheffler is kind of settling in, though. He's not going to have fall off like Jordan did after that one sort of choky hole. I forget that what tournament that was. It seems like Scheffler just stays there and doesn't fall off like Rory does randomly.
Spieth did that at Augusta. It was the 12th hole at Augusta. He did it twice, actually, where he put it in the water, and he hasn't been the same since. So,
how'd your prediction on Tiger Woods go?
Not well. He made the cut, Dan. Tiger Woods should be offered a golf cart. I'm serious. He should be afforded a golf cart.
Wow.
Because if you want your sport to stay relevant and you want Tiger to compete in these tournaments, the reason he's not competing is because he has to walk. And Augusta is very, very hilly. And it is tough at his age, Dan, with his body in this physical condition, for him to walk those holes. I've seen him try to walk those holes. It's very difficult. Give him a golf cart. If he can cart from shot to ball, shot to ball, shot to ball, he has a chance of winning 10 more majors.
I'll do you one better. Giving him a 15-stroke lead. Stugatz, we have a new segment here we're debuting because we want to celebrate just the general gas baggery that we have throughout sports. Some folks over the weekend, Stugatz, wrote in claiming of your WFAN program director offer that the morning show on FAN was reporting that they turned you down, not that you turned them down. I did not.
Does it matter? An offer was made. I said no. I mean, that's it. Okay? I mean.
Well, no, their argument is they said no.
Okay.
I don't know.
Gia was literally begging me to take the job. I mean.
Is that their morning show? Is Gio their morning show?
Yeah, Gio and Boomer.
Okay. Is he in charge of the hiring?
Booms.
I'm sorry.
No, but he's got a 12 share at the radio station, so I guess he has some say.
Well, who are these guys who are going to be celebrated here in our new... This would have been some of the guys that you would have fired upon getting to WFAN.
Or promoted.
If you had taken the job. Look, man, did you not see what he did when he was program director here? He immediately put himself in drive time. Like, he was not going to sit around...
Well, it was middays, to be honest with you.
You and me were not middays.
Well, I was middays, and then I think you called me like a week before saying you didn't want to do the show by yourself, and I removed myself from middays, and I came to do the show with you, and I hired Craig Minervini.
Sacrificial.
Many in the middays.
But you were never on middays.
The station hadn't started yet. I mean.
But you just said you were on middays when you weren't on middays.
I originally penciled myself in.
You put yourself in. The first day, the first day the station existed, you were on in drive time.
I know, but I initially penciled myself in as a midday host, you in the afternoons, Joe Rose in the mornings, and a national show somewhere in the midday there. And then you said you didn't want to do the show by yourself. I gave up the midday position. I gave it to Minnie in the midday. I think OJ eventually joined him. And I did
OJ McDuffie. With you. Yeah. OJ McDuffie.
Yeah.
OJ,
have to clarify.
Good clarification.
Not OJ Simpson.
OJ McDuffie, OJ Simpson. The Dolphin wide receiver.
Complicated legacy, huh?
Yeah.
Oh, God.
It's not a complicated legacy.
We did
legacy.
Middays.
Well, we called it a complicated legacy on our show right after it happened. So.
I mean,
it was.
It's not a complicated legacy.
It's complicated, Dan.
It's horrific. It's a horrific legacy. It's not complicated.
Did you see him at SC?
There are a number of people, I won't name names, who are very bummed that Stugatz didn't get this job because they believed Stugatz would have taken them with him and given them the morning slot on WFAN.
Taylor?
And I'm not saying they would call it the Taylor and Tony show, but I am saying that there are a number of people that are very unhappy about this development.
Well, who'd they be replacing? Like, who are these guys here that get our initial victory here for Gas Bag of the Week?
Gas Bag of the Week.
So wait, let's get into it now. Hold
okay,
on, Rich,
and
hold
thank
on.
You for the call, Rich.
Get into what?
Yes, he's looking for a walk. Soto's looking for a walk. Now, I love Juan Soto.
Yeah.
And John Harper, my colleague at SNY, correctly predicted I would at some point go nuts about Soto looking for a walk. A walk is not as good as a hit. And when you have Judge struggling and you got the pitcher on the ropes, you got first and second in a spot right there where you need to do damage. Mm-hmm. You're Juan Soto. You need to do damage, not draw a walk. And Juan Soto's looking for a walk. Swing the bat, bro. That's what you want to get paid? Swing the bat. I don't care if he's a Yankee, if he's a Met. I cannot accept a walk in that spot from Juan Soto. That does not get the job done. Passing the baton is not what I'm looking for from Juan Soto. I'm looking for him to do some damage. Now, if you don't get plenty of pitches to hit, fine. Soto was looking for a walk in that at bat. So much so that when he walked, it was like he accomplished some great feat. Oh, here we go, baby. I'm pumped up. I walk. No. No, you didn't get the job done. You passed the baton to Judge, who's been cold, and he didn't get the job done. Soto failed.
Juan Soto has some of the best plate discipline in the history of the sport. The pitch that he's asking him to swing at was practically in the dirt. But if that's not sports radio, I don't know what is.
The greatest.
Take a walk. Do some damage.
The Yankees are 12-4. I mean, honestly, how could I improve that show?
Also, after him is Aaron Judge. And then after that is Stanton. So it's not like he's their only bat in the lineup and he has to bring in the runs.
But Aaron Judge is struggling, Billy. He did make that point. Also, Angel Hernandez would have ruled all of those strikes.
Oh,
so.
Yeah.
Stugatz, the Stugatz move is strong in that show, beginning the criticism with, I love Juan Soto.
Mm-hmm.
However.
Yes. how you have to do it.
And then, everything that comes after that suggests that you don't actually love Juan Soto, when one of the greatest things about Juan Soto is that he's got great plate discipline.
You have already put up the Juan Soto umbrella. So you have stated on the front end that you love him. Anything that you say after that doesn't matter because you love him. I mean, you can criticize him all you want. You've already stated that you love him. Sal, I'm proud of you. That's how you do it. I mean, I don't care what you say about me.
I'm surprised there's not an argument as to Juan Soto, why he's batting second in the lineup and why they're not going after Aaron Boone.
Why would they be going after Aaron Boone?
Because they hate Aaron Boone.
You don't think Aaron Judge or Giancarlo Stanton should be batting in the middle of the lineup?
No.
Your second hitter is your best
Soto.
Hitter.
He's your best hitter.
No.
Yeah, in modern baseball.
Not according to these guys.
Well, it's supposed to be your best
hitter.
Who's
these guys?
I don't know what their names are. Sal and something or other.
Mm-hmm. That should be the name of the show. Sal and something or another.
I'm not saying this to like cause a problem. I thought it was the same person arguing with himself and then just like put on glasses. I didn't realize those two people
at
the beginning.
Let me see it again. Let me see it again, and let me see if I see what Billy sees of the same. This is a great. You should do that bit, incidentally. You should do Billy arguing with evil Billy, where you just put on your glasses and argue the other side.
Okay, my dog.
All the Billys are evil.
Let's get into it now. Hold
okay,
on, Rich,
and
hold
thank
on.
You for the call, Rich.
Get into what?
Yes, he's looking for a walk. Soto's looking for
a put on a red hoodie and then a blue hoodie.
My colleague, as I correctly predicted, I would at some point go nuts about Soto looking for a walk. A walk is not as good as a hit. And when you have Judge struggling and you got the pitcher on the ropes, you got first and second in a spot right there where you need to do damage. Mm-hmm. You're Juan Soto. You need to do damage, not draw a walk. And Juan Soto's looking for a walk. Swing the bat, bro. That's what you want to get paid? Swing the bat. I don't care if he's a Yankee, if he's a Met. I cannot accept a walk in that spot from Juan Soto. That does not get the job done. Passing the baton is not what I'm looking for from Juan Soto. I'm looking for him to do some damage. Now, if you don't get plenty of pitches to hit, fine. Soto was looking for a walk in that at bat. So much so that when he walked, it was like he accomplished some great feat. Oh, here we go, baby. I'm pumped up. I walk. No, you didn't get the job done. You passed the baton to Judge, who's been cold, and he didn't get the job done. Soto failed.
Jeremy, can you tell me, is Soto 26 years old? How many times has he led the league in walks? At what, 26? Is he even 26 years old?
Soto has led the league in walks 3 times. Soto is 25 years old. So that's already happened 3 times. He made his debut at 19.
He's batting .344. He has 15 RBIs already. He has a career on base percentage of .422 because he walks.
That's correct.
He has an OPS over 1,000. It's a 191 OPS plus. 100 is average.
Soto failed because he left the bases loaded for Judge. I don't think the Yankees don't want to be in bases loaded situations for Judge.
Taylor and Tony would have done a much better.
I think we want to go with TVTC somewhere, something with that. Mm.
What do you imagine that would sound
like?
Wait,
what is that?
Do you guys want
TV, Taylor's initials, TC, mine.
How about TNT?
Ooh, TNT.
TNT.
That's why you're the program director. Yeah, exactly. That's why he's the program
TNT.
Director.
Yep.
Shouldn't it be AC Dynamite. TV?
No, TNT. We're going TNT. Okay.
TNT is good. He wanted to put Marty Fish and Andy Roddick together so it could be Fish and Rod.
Yeah. Ooh. That's why I'm a
PD,
Dano.
That's as good as it gets.
Yeah.
He also would want to put LeBron James and Michael Jordan together and call it GOATs or something.
Wow.
That doesn't mean it's going to happen.
Electric.
Well, very often all he has is the idea of a name, and that's all he's got.
That's all you really need sometimes.
That's all exactly you need when you're right. A PD, Dano.
Podcast P. Does anybody know if Paul George does a good podcast? No.
Doesn't
the name
matter.
Of the podcast?
Mm-hmm.
Good enough.
You know what I'm thinking now, though? They both do podcasts. I mean, there's no reason that Tom Brady and LeBron James can't be doing a podcast together.
Yep. Mm. Couple of goats cutting it up,
mm-hmm.
Except one's not a goat. I mean,
yeah, it would have to be Jordan, I guess, and Tom Brady. Has anyone heard the Savannah James podcast? I was surprised that she was doing that because she has been
what's
very,
the name of it?
Very purposeful.
Terrible name if that's a podcast.
Yeah, we don't know the name.
Well, then if you don't know the name, then I'm not going to listen to it.
What are we doing? Come
on. It seems she has been pretty purposeful about staying private. We don't know very much about her, and we certainly haven't heard from her very much. I don't know why it is she's getting into the podcast game or what it is that she wants wants to accomplish with that. But shortly before LeBron entered that arena with J.J. Redick, she did that. And I found myself not curious enough to actually listen, but waiting for somebody else to listen and report to me what it is that Savannah James is doing with her podcast.
We found the name. It's Everybody's Crazy.
That's crazy.
Bad name. Bad name.
Is it a bad name?
Yeah, yeah. It doesn't have Savannah in it. Yeah. The whole point is to have the name in the name.
Gotta work Savannah.
No, not if you're looking to take some time off. You start the podcast. You know, then you go on vacation.
Co-host?
Everybody's crazy. Then every once in a while Savannah's there, but if she doesn't want to host,
with Savannah.
Imagine naming a show the Dan Le Batard Show.
Right.
And then someone tunes in and Dan Le Batard is not there. You'd be like, forget this. I'm out. You tune into Everybody's Crazy. You don't know if it's a Savannah podcast, if it's a Bronny podcast, whose podcast it is. Just Everybody's Crazy.
You've been spending too much time with Stukas.
No, it's like the Golic family podcast. Billy is right about this. Just one member of the Golic family needs to show up each week.
However, if you tune into the Golic family podcast and it's the Wiener family, you're like, I'm out.
Billy is feeling a bit rambunctious today because I don't know if any of you saw that the Marlins had the chance to win a series against the Braves yesterday.
I hate the Braves.
And the way that they lost, they're winning 7-6 in the ninth inning. They've got Scott pitching. He's been good all season. He's
he
been good.
Sucks.
He's
awful this season. Tremendous last year.
Garbage
as a pitcher. Great guy.
He has not
been garbage.
That guy.
Say that on the front end, Billy.
Their bullpen has been bad. He has not been. He's been one of their most reliable people in the bullpen for the better part of more than a season. And he's up 0-2 on Marcel Ozuna. 0-2.
Two outs. Up one.
So they're a strike away, but Acuna terrifies me anytime he's on base. And then Ozuna hits a home run to straightaway center.
Ozuna was flirting with a home run all day because he hit the wall twice. The one that he hit in the first inning, it ended up being a single or whatever inning it was. Ended up being a single because he wasn't jogging it out. It was dead center field, hits the top of the wall. He doesn't go past first base. Then he pulls one and he hits it like 2 feet past where the wall dips, where if it was 2 feet over, it would have been gone. He was hunting a home run all day. Sneaky good season for Marcel Ozuna.
I mean, he's sneaky good career for Marcel Ozuna. Yeah. I don't understand how it is he's allowed to play baseball games given what's on his resume.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's the part. Sneaky good career, except for, you know, all the terrible things he did off the field.
I would listen to a podcast called The Wiener Family.
We have a little update. So I mentioned that there was a statue in Dublin where everyone rubs the boobs. And I was saying in Slack how men are so horny that they'll literally rub the boobs of a statue. And then we found out, the video team discovered, there's a statue in France where women rub this statue's penis because they think it will give them good fertility luck. So that is the rubbed penis of a statue in France.
And they kiss the mouth, it looks like.
Apparently. So this is all just another reason why maybe it's better to not have a statue.
Newsflash, everybody's horny.
Put it on the poll, please, at Le Batard Show. Are men so horny that they will touch the
good
boobs?
Good podcast name.
Of a statue.
Everyone's horny, not are men so horny that they'll touch the boobs of a statue.
We have been talking for a while about how CBS's demo is Angela Lansbury. That it's what CBS is just going for generally. And last night on Sunday night, and this is reassuring. First of all, they start in the morning with that CBS magazine show, and they've got no problem going 90 seconds just watching a stream.
That's what Jane Pauley's all about.
So good. 90 seconds just hearing the sounds of a stream. Yeah. But
at that age, a 90-second stream, oh.
The day ending with Stugatz, Masters, 60 minutes, and then a Billy Joel concert that for some reason they cut away from in the middle of Piano Man to go to the local news on.
They somehow skewed older as the day went on, and they started with golf.
It's so hard to do. It's so hard to do, and yet CBS managed to do it. I imagine their late-night programming was just mummies.
I'm so tired of the local news cutting into things and you missing shows because of the local news. Like, respectfully, local news, who cares? Like, I know the news. By 11 o'clock, I'm in bed. I've checked the news. I know the news for the day.
This was crazy because Billy Joel was his 100th show at Madison Square Garden, which is, it's really cool to have a residency there It's really, really
cool. He
does
it once a month, correct?
He does it once a month. It was his 100th show. But he's singing Piano Man. He's getting to the good stuff. He's got like 5 or 6 songs left in him. And they cut to CBS Local News, and I was outraged. I was still awake, and I was outraged. I wanted to see the end of Piano Man.
But he's done it 100 times.
I know.
And also, not to like reveal too much in case Lehman's family's listening, but they gave us tickets to go see that when we were in New York, and we were like, oh, we can't go. We have plans.
Wow.
Really?
I mean, we did have plans, but we could have canceled.
Did you sell them?
Sells out all the time.
They sold the tickets. The rest of his family went. But Lehman's like,
put it on the poll, please, Juju, at Lebatard Show. Can you cut into Piano Man for the local news?
You can't.
Very little in journalism has taken the hit that local news has taken in terms of daily relevance.
You know what the local news is great for? Cut in and tell me when there's a tornado. People always complain about that, but that is a vital... There was a tornado
unless it's a show I like, then leave me alone.
If you're breaking into Piano Man, it better be a Cat 5, and it better be right over my house.
I'd better be missing my house after the news update is done if you're cutting into Piano Man.
He's done Piano Man 100 times.
This happened during the Masters this weekend, right? Where there was that scary 5 seconds where the announcer says we're cutting to CBS News for a special announcement, and it's like breaking news, and I'm like, what war are we in? Like, what is happening? If you're cutting it, you get those 5 seconds where like, I have no idea what's about to happen.
You're breaking
into
Masters.
It was Iran sending drones to Israel, and it was just like, I have no idea what's going to happen here.
Freak me out. I feel like that's a good reason to cut in.
Yeah.
America is in unprecedented territory. For the first time, a former United States president faces criminal charges in court. In one corner, a sleazy, slutty prostitute with no shame or credibility. In the other, Stormy Daniels. Donald Trump faces charges that he paid $130,000 in hush money to a porn star. No former president has ever stood trial before. This is the first of 4 criminal trials Donald Trump faces.
This is very serious.
Right.
Was that Hank?
Is that a live cut-in? I mean,
that was a live cut-in.
We're just getting to the good part of the Dan Le Batard Show. It's Stu.
My
it's
house better be like, missing after
what
this.
Happened here? What are we doing?
That's happening today. A criminal trial that's never happened before. On trial for felonies, a former U.S. president. I'm going to give you just some bonus facts on Donald Trump over the course of the show today, just so that we don't normalize some of the stuff that is happening, including, again, the first ever United States president with a criminal trial. And this is apparently the least damaging of the 4 trials. If reelected, this is a bonus fact, Donald Trump reportedly wants to bring back firing squads.
Cool. Sounds good.
As president, Donald Trump spent $15,000 a month in taxpayer dollars on golf carts.
For Tiger or?
As president, go sit outside, Jeremy. As president, Donald Trump appointed a surgeon to run the housing department. Donald Trump has claimed that his daughter has personally created 14 million jobs.
That's more jobs than Tony's created.
That's so
when
many
you're in
jobs,
economy, Bobby, you know?
That's so many jobs, 14 million jobs. That's a thing that's happening during the show today. It's not just felonious criminal trial. It's also involving a porn star. Be a little hard to disgrace the office more than that.
A little hard, phrasing.
How do we feel about how serious that sounded? Was that Hank? That was Hank. That sounded like Hank.
More concerned about the timing.
The voice actor of a generation. When is the right time to break into felonious former U.S. president on trial for...
Not when we're talking Piano Man.
For hush.
He's done it 100 times. Can't really be mad. Also, speaking of like CBS's demographic, I keep seeing clips from the concert Greg Cody went to in L.A. and all the old crooners that were on stage, include some young crooners too, I will admit, but like I can't think of a more Greg Cody thing than that concert. I'm excited to hear from him tomorrow.
And Will Arnett.
The average age had to have been in like the mid-80s.
He's going to be so tired tomorrow.
I saw Will Arnett in the middle
right
of that.
Right in the middle of it.
Pitbull right at the end of it for some reason.
He was
Pitbull.
Killing it over on the side.
He's
yeah.
a little older now.
I found myself feeling some of what Billy found himself feeling with one of the things that happened at Coachella, Stugat. Will Smith came out and did a version of Men in Black, and I don't know that Will Smith has made it back from that Oscar slap yet. He's going to one of his franchises by going and doing Bad Boys, and that's going to supposedly it just got done filming here in Miami, and it's coming out in June, super fast. And I assume it's tied to Will Smith trying to get back into the game in some ways, because he's largely just gone away, has he not, since slapping Chris Rock at the Oscars?
Well, not by choice. He was kind of forced away, right? Like, it seemed like everyone was trying to get away from him. I feel like, and I could be wrong, Will Smith was only doing Men in Black because of the Chris Rock slap, right? Like, this is him trying to, like, make his public reappearance, and look, I'm doing this thing.
It's a safe zone. Like,
yeah, but had that not happened, do you think that in 2024 Will Smith would be at Coachella performing the Men in Black song?
I think it's the same reason he's doing Bad Boys, that both of those, like, these are very...
Well, that money.
Bad Boys for a check, though.
Yeah, come on.
Oh, but I think he wants back in with the signature things that people remember him positively for. Bad Boys and Men in Black are obviously... two of them, and these economies are so giant, Stugatz, with so many employees. They're all trying so hard to figure out the correct way to sustain the economy, to not have the economy further damage, because Will Smith, over a 10-year run, you could have made the argument that he was the biggest movie star in Hollywood. That, for 10 years, you could have made that argument. And certainly, if not the biggest star, top five, top 10.
Oh, easily, Dan.
I mean, but then I Am Legend came out, and that was that.
Yeah.
Well, it's his personal life that doesn't allow him to remain this way, right? Because you get the slap, and you get all these things about his personal life that you hear, and maybe people lose respect for him, and then all of a sudden, hey, maybe he shouldn't be the main man on a $20 million salary movie. Like, I think that reputation... is sort of where he lost a lot of respect from fans. And if you put him in front of things, if you put him, as a head man in a movie, I think it's probably going to get laughed at. At least it was, between the slap and now.
Billy, you felt pity for him over the weekend.
I felt bad because he's, out there, and I don't think that he'd be doing this had that not happened. And it was kind of like awkward.
Had he not slapped Chris Rock, he chose to do that. But you're saying if he didn't do it, if he chose not to do it.
He did choose that.
He did choose to do
that.
That was his choice. Yes. But I think he was doing it from a noble place. I'm still trying to understand that whole situation.
He's also chosen some bad movies throughout the last couple of years. Yeah. Like, Gemini Man was terrible. And it's like, how many more times can we put him attached to a movie that it's like, oh, it's Will Smith, but like, wow, this movie sucks.
He was an orc on Netflix somewhere.
I will say this.
I don't know what that means.
If you were if you were at Coachella and you were on drugs and there's this giant alien head there, and then all of a sudden there's a bunch of dancing aliens and Will Smith appears.
What do you mean
Smith
if,
appears,
by the way? If you were on
that
drugs.
That probably did very well.
I mean, that sounds awesome. Have you guys ever done the Men in Black ride at Universal?
Oh, I love
if
that
If that's
ride.
Will Smith's yes. legacy, like, that's a great that legacy ride. To have.
Hey,
it's the best ride.
Can I get spoiler alert on the Men in Black ride.
Wait, tell me.
Spoiler alert.
Is there like a key to winning it?
Spoiler alert. The entire ride, they tell you, don't push that button. You push it. Yeah. Right when they say,
what?
Yeah, right at the end, there's a moment where they say push it, and the first person that pushes it in the cart gets a ton of bonus points.
That's right.
Yeah, spoiler alert.
Wow.
That's
everybody spins
good
around.
Information.
Dan, have you ever been on that ride?
I
we
got to
do a theme park as a show
Such
together.
I'll go
Universal
with
Let's
the show.
Do it. Let's have a show theme park.
Dan,
day.
When was the last time you went to a theme park, got into a ride?
I have been on a ride, and you're going to have to help me with which one it is. There's a lot of shooting.
The Avatar
a
one.
A lot of shooting. No,
Buzz
I've been
Lightyear.
On that one.
Men
I've
in
been
Black.
On the Avatar
Men in Black
one,
is a shooting
it's
game.
Target shooting.
That's Men in Black. You're talking
okay,
about
Men
in
Buzz
Black.
Lightyear.
It's the best.
Buzz
that,
Lightyear.
It's so memorable.
Is it the game where you shoot the plates?
You shoot the aliens.
It's. I was
Toy Story Mania.
I was terrible at getting the points. Everybody was beating me. I was not very good at shooting. I don't remember what
we
were shooting.
Hmm.
And you always say your button's broken on the gun. It's like, yeah, it's jammed. I don't know what's happening.
Something's
here.
Going on here. Classic.
We're frustrated.
Yeah. Sensor's not working.
I've told you before, that last week, though, the Avatar ride is the single most amazing ride I've ever been on. The single most realistic, ridiculous ride I have ever seen. It had eight-hour lines when we were there.
Short the fact that it's all fantasy land, so it's not that realistic.
You clearly haven't been on the Hagrid ride, Dan. Come on.
It's a children's roller coaster.
You didn't get sick by that one, Dan? When you're there and it's like the things are moving.
It gives me
moving.
A mareo.
It gives me tremendo mareo.
Yeah.
Makes
the
me
video
throw
ones,
up.
I hate
no,
it.
Thank you. I want reality, Jack.
Izzy knows a great deal about the history of basketball, and we were talking about Jalen Brunson here and his glow up in going into New York. And I just don't think that we've had many basketball players ever who have been able to change without winning a championship the way they are viewed more than Jimmy Butler. During the last postseason, he was photographed in Paris with Shakira, and it was surmised or whispered, it was never confirmed, that they may have been seeing each other. And then last week, and this is the continuation of what appears to be a public flirtation, Camila Cabello is on the sidelines there, and Jimmy is fooling around behind her, just taking pictures while his team is in the timeout huddle. He's just fooling around outside of it. And I wanted to ask the group, because I think I may be alone in here, having watched Jimmy all season, knowing how hard those free throws are to come by, seeing where his legs sometimes betrayed him, even during last year's finals, I'm not sitting here expecting more of these 40-point games from Jimmy. I don't believe that playoff Jimmy's going to make an appearance with a bunch of 15-for-21s. And Stugat says he's done doubting Jimmy in any form, but I just don't think you can keep putting that kind of mileage on the body and legs. Maybe.
I had no idea where that question was going, Dan. You started off with telling everybody that I know NBA history, and then we go through Shakira, Camila?
Camila Cabello.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And now we're asking if Jimmy can be playoff Jimmy. Is that the question?
I am asking if I'm the only one here who doesn't expect it this year. I'm not expecting them.
No.
You're with me on this, Jessica?
I'm with you on this, Dan.
Yes.
I'm with you in this respect. He only needs one of those a series.
Correct.
He needs one game a series to show everybody, hey, I can still do this if necessary. Fortunately, I've got a bunch of talented teammates as well. Don't need to do it every time.
The thing with Jimmy and when it comes to free throws is if he averages between 12 and 14 free throws a game, which he's very capable of doing, that helps this team so much and slows down the game. Like, I don't know if we can expect that against Philadelphia, for example, because they're a matchup nightmare for him to get into the paint and be able to produce that
but
way
this
he struggled
is,
against them recently.
This is if you're going to summon this thing that he can summon allegedly whenever he wants to, it's needed right now. You need to get the two. You need to be playing the two seed, not the one seed. Like, if right now the playoffs begin, obviously, by schedule, but if Jimmy Butler's going to do the 15 free throw thing, now is the time that it needs to be done. You do not want the Boston Celtics first.
Yeah, that's exactly right. And I would expect him to do that. Does it mean 45 points like he had against Milwaukee or in those Lakers games several years ago? No, not necessarily. Oftentimes, the best version of Jimmy Butler and the best version of this year's team in particular is him shooting 12 to 14 free throws, getting to about 28 points officially, and also adding 6 or 7 dimes. Because that's where, when you're getting the rest of this team involved with them, it's been all about ball movement. Last year, driving into the lane and kicking out to Max and Gabe for threes was a huge part of their offense. This year, it's all been ball movement when that team looks good offensively.
If you doubt Jimmy enough, Dan, if you doubt him enough times, eventually you're going to be right. But I think he thrives on going to Philadelphia, going to a place that got rid of Jimmy Butler for Tobias Harris. Like, I think he thrives on playing that game in Philadelphia and having a big game in Philadelphia.
My point is that This is the situation for it to make an appearance, and I don't expect them. I expect them to go to Philadelphia and lose.
This is where I agree with you is now, this is the time. Because of the play, and because you're saying, hey, Boston in the first round is you're asking to be knocked out. So this needs to be treated like a Game 7. If you were going into a Game 7 with Jimmy Butler, you're expecting now is the time, especially when you got Philly. Tobias Harris over me, the Ben Simmons situation. Like, he's got all the motivation to dominate this one game and say, okay, Embiid, you go deal with the Celtics. I don't expect it, however.
In an effort to be the voice of the audience, I am so exhausted by the playoff Jimmy conversation. Like, this year, the Heat have just felt, like, very, especially vibeless, I think.
But they're the same as last year. They're the same as last year.
They're better than last year.
They're the same team.
No
Struce. They're more hurt. They've been more hurt this year.
They're better than last year.
Are they? They had the same record.
The players on the team are better than the players on the team last year.
That's right.
Jovic, Terry Rozier, two upgrades right there.
I don't know. I'm exhausted by it.
Right. But it hasn't even started
yet. I feel like we've done the same. Like, we just did the same seasons back-to-back year. Like, we're doing it all over again.
Right.
Again and again and again.
And you're choosing not to trust someone who has done it 2 times in 3 years.
I understand what you're doing there, but I will say, and I continue to say, how spoiled this market is. This unacceptable season for the Heat is the best Knicks season in 10 years. The Knicks are presently celebrating.
Don't make it about the Knicks.
No, but the Knicks are super excited and loud. New York is awfully loud about being the 2 seed, Stugatz, because they think they've done something by winning 50 games, and they'll tell you at every turn that if they hadn't been injured, they would have won a lot more games. That team is the 2 seed in the conference and is feeling itself when it's just put up a season that has frustrated Heat fans. The same season. The difference between the Knicks and the Heat this year is that the Heat lost to Memphis at home, Washington at home, and twice to Brooklyn. That's the difference between the two teams. And it's not because the Heat are less good than those teams. It's because the Heat have not put any sort of importance on the regular season if you're looking how many other guys are sitting out all
the
time.
But it's obviously about expectations. The Heat have different kind of expectations. They expect when you have teams with LeBron and Wade and those types of teams – that win NBA championships, and Wade and Shaq, they expect to win championships or compete for championships. The Knicks are just happy to be there.
All right, but if that's the expectation, then here's what I've got for you. Sixers are historic chokers. Embiid has never won an important game. You've got one against them right now. You want Philadelphia out of your life? Make them play Boston. You want Philadelphia out of here? Beat them now. All the Tobias Harris stuff, you chose Tobias Harris over me. Here you go. I just think the Jimmy I've seen this year doesn't have those legs. Jimmy I've seen this year looks like Jimmy against Denver in the finals, where he just didn't have what it is that I wanted from him. Now, maybe because it's so hard, Stugatz, physically on the body, if I were him, I would also say, I'm not doing the 15 free throws a game until I get to the playoffs. I've got no reason to do it. LeBron said the quiet part out loud the other day, Stugatz. He said, I'm not jeopardizing my health for seeding. Do not care where the seeding is. I have to be healthy for game one of the playoffs. That's the thing that's more important. So if Jimmy's out there trying to get 20 free throws, that's how he gets to the 40 points.
This is a bad time for Jimmy to rely on that, because we saw this second half of the regular season, referees swallowed whistles. They're not, those same playoff fouls he was getting last season were often not being called right now in the regular season. So if you imagine it's going to get tougher to get those calls in the playoffs, good luck, Jimmy.
And it was so interesting because last game against the 76ers, one that the Heat needed, Jimmy really didn't play all that well. He, I think, was 7 of 17 from the field in that game, inefficient. And the biggest thing that you noticed was Kyle Lowry oftentimes was guarding him. He had the mismatch and yet wasn't going into the paint, wasn't trying to go into the paint, wasn't trying to back down Kyle Lowry. I don't understand why he didn't take advantage in that regular season game. But to your point, Dan, if you're not trying to go that through that physical toll in a regular season game, I don't care about seeding, blah, 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 I'll be ready for the playoffs. You would expect that switch to flip come Wednesday.
The thing is, it's almost you don't know if you can't flip the switch until you can't flip the switch, right? You get to a point where it's like, oh, it's Kyle Lowry. Yeah, like he stopped me on the block four times. I couldn't get anything on Kyle Lowry. But it's the chess move of, wait, I'll do it in the playoffs. Well, now you're here. Now you're going to see Kyle Lowry in the block again when he stopped you four different times on four different plays. Like now it's here, Jimmy.
I remember the first part of the 2010s with the San Antonio Spurs, what they looked like. Whenever they won, they were experienced, and whenever they lost, they were old. That's how that one happened, and we've talked before about it's not whether Jimmy can do it once. For sure he can do it once. It's can you do it four times in seven games so that you get it to the next round so that we can get to watch it again. It's that as you age, what leaves you is your ability to consistently do it. Not to do it, because you can still do it. It's consistently do it. You lose the consistency.
We already had that. We've already experienced those. And at the end of the series, if they lose it, we say, oh, Bam needs to do more. Oh, they need Tyler to be healthy. It's not Jimmy needs to do it more often. And so for you to say it's four times in a series, that's way too much.
Why is Jimmy the guy that we're questioning in the playoff equation
here? So weird.
He's done it. He's taken two teams to the NBA Finals. The guys we should be looking at are guys like Tatum, Jaylen Brown, Donovan Mitchell.
Because I think Duncan Robinson is more important from what I've seen from them this year.
Than Jimmy Butler.
I've seen all year Jimmy Butler put up 90-point games when he doesn't have Duncan Robinson out there. The way that they've been playing with Duncan Robinson, I'm not saying that Duncan Robinson's a better player. What I am saying is the same thing that the LeBron James, Norris Cole Heat said about Chris Bosh. Chris Bosh isn't better than LeBron James, but he's more important to what it is that they were doing.
To be clear, Jimmy Butler did not have 90 points in the game multiple times.
No, I like this, though, as a premise for the show. Like, we just stop talking about Jimmy Butler and just put all the pressure on Duncan Robinson. Yes. He has to have a good playoff.
Jeremy, you have been watching a whole bunch of 90.
He's not playing? What?
90
oh
point.
Oh, my God. The
We're
Heat
doomed.
Are screwed.
Thanks for watching. Screwed.
90-point Miami Heat games with Jimmy Butler and Bam out there. It's why they traded for Rozier.
Right. They needed instant offense. Duncan Robinson is probably their third most important player throughout this season. Kevin Love, who just got hurt on Sunday, another hugely important player to providing offense and the way he gets the ball down the floor. But Terry Rozier, and for that matter, Tyler Hero, who we have not been talking about all season because he missed a handful of games, or handful, he missed 20 games. Yeah. He's been great since returning offensively. He's been their best player offensively, a factor that wasn't there last postseason. So when you talk about this team and you talk about what you need in a series, Tyler Hero is ultimately going to be a really, really important piece to what they do offensively.
So I understand that, Jeremy, but the question that I have now is when you have all these mismatched pieces that haven't played together, you got Rozier, you've got Tyler, you've got Bam, you've got Jimmy, you've got Duncan if he comes back later on, how are they going to all work together? There's one ball, yep. Right? Like it's Jimmy centric
culture
world, but like you can only hold down Tyler Hero on shots so long. You can only hold down Terry Rozier on shots for so long.
Well, that's what I was saying about ball movement with this team, because realistically, as many individual pieces that exist that are there that can go get theirs, right? They have four different guys who are 20-point a game scorers. That's not what it's been when this team is good. When this team is good, they've got six or seven different guys scoring in double figures. They're moving the ball. It's not just Jimmy iso ball. And we've seen late in games throughout the regular season them struggle when it's gone to just iso ball. That's when they've gone through these stretches of 6 or 7 minutes without scoring. The hope is that Jimmy's able to elevate his game, get to his spots, hit some big shots late. But that hasn't been what's been good about this team this season. They are a different team from last year. Mm-hmm. It's just that we're looking at the overall Jimmy era and saying, all right, they're just about the same every year.
Oh, God, I'm a Jess. This is exhausting.
While they haven't played together that many times, and it is going to be kind of a difficult job for Spo to figure this out and make all these pieces work together, this is when you really lean into that culture.
Oh, don't do that.
I hate you.
I knew the setup when he was going on. I was like,
this is what they do in the off season. This is when they do the training camps at the
Let
Army
me restate
bases.
What I was saying before. What I was saying before, just to be clear, that they've looked their best this season when Duncan Robinson is starting. They were like 16-2 or something when he was starting and scoring 20 points. And,
most improved player ever.
And Jimmy Butler can go through the postseason going 7-for-17 which is what I thought he was when he got here. If they're getting that,
what he was.
If they're getting that from Duncan Robinson, their offenses look totally different when he's playing. Totally different.
This is Tyler Hero's playoffs to lose.
Yeah,
is what I'm hearing.
I think you guys are forgetting the way Philadelphia just attacked him on the defensive end when he played at the end of that
very
game.
Very exposed.
They were up by 8 points, and they didn't hit a bucket in the final eight
That's
minutes.
Right, and Philadelphia kept the whole time attacking Tyler Hero when Miami wasn't scoring at all. Stugatz, did you see what happened with Boban yesterday in a game for the Houston Rockets that didn't mean anything because they're out of the playoffs?
I did not, no. Nope.
Toward the end of the game, are you learning right now that Boban is on the Houston Rockets? Is that something that you're presently learning in real time?
Yes.
All right, so Boban, at the end of this game, they are up by 7 or 8 points. And the crowd gets free chicken if he misses a second consecutive free throw. If the opponent misses two free throws, the crowd gets chicken. He is not a good free throw shooter.
Mm-hmm.
He is let's watch him here. Let's play this. He has got unusually sized ears, Stugatz.
Yeah.
For a man of any size, but especially
though,
his size.
Yeah.
Are they proportional?
I don't know, I feel
ears?
Like
yeah, they're proportional.
I think of Boban as somebody who starred in John Wick. I don't even associate him anymore with basketball. I associate him with the John Wick movies. But watch what happens here when he realizes that he can get the home crowd, he can get them some chicken with some missed free throws.
Fans are getting excited here. There might potentially be some free chicken on the board if he misses the second free throw.
Oh, man, free chicken on the board.
Yeah, so that's why the fans are getting a little frothy.
Oh, they're pointing to anything. Boban's playing with the crowd. Say, you want chicken?
Here's your job.
Oh, he gave him chicken. He's a man of the people. He's a man of the people.
He did that on purpose.
He did. He gave out free chicken.
Career 78% free throw shooter, Dan.
Oh, is he? Okay, my bad.
He gave them chicken is one of the greatest yes. calls in sports broadcasting history.
I think, put it on the poll, please, Juju. Should he gave them chicken replace Do You Believe in Miracles as one of the greatest calls in broadcasting history? I believe the announcer also said he's a man of the people, which he absolutely is.
Oh, when you get someone food, you're a man of the people. Yeah. I love free food being attached to sports accomplishments. I had a free Whopper Jr. yesterday, thanks to the Marlins winning at home. It took a long time to get there. But we finally got there.
Mm.
And here's the trick, friends, if you want to know how you beat the system until they figure out this trick and then you can no longer beat the system.
Gain the system?
Well, one, Burger King gained the system because they have to win games at home. That has been much of a challenge this year. The second, but the way that you as a consumer gain the system, you can get one per account. So if you and a loved one want to go together, you can each order one of these free sandwiches. Wow. And then there's lunch for freezies. Went in there yesterday with two different phones. They looked at me like I was a crazy person, but I had two phones. Lunch on them.
How are you guys using the verb? What is the verb you're saying on blank?
I don't know.
Blank the system? How is it that you were
beat
saying?
The system?
No, but you
gaining
said
the system.
Game the system?
It's, gain the
it's
system.
Game, not gain, right?
I don't
it's
know.
Game the system.
It's game. You guys definitely said gain.
Yeah, it's a fun.
Tax day.
I was just curious whether or not sometimes I get
good
that
point.
Stuff wrong. Yeah. So, yes, it is to game the system. What would gaining the system be?
I have no idea. Well, I would have drained that free throw, though. Yeah. I mean,
I'd argue, like, in this situation, you gain a free meal, so you've gained the system.
Izzy, are you sure you read the stats correctly? Boban's a 78% free throw shooter?
Okay, I was slightly off. 76, but it's still
good.
For
his career?
For his career, yes.
Okay, I'm stunned by that.
I explained to my wife over the weekend that there's a Boban Marjanovic, Bogdan Bogdanovic, and Bogdan Marjanovic, I think, or Bojan Marjanovic.
And you explained this.
I did. I was trying
and
to explain it at least. And now I just messed it up because I literally was trying to explain over the weekend because of this video. And that's
at least
how
your
much
wife is clear
I
on
had.
This, though, right?
We have a good time.
She's so confused.
She loves me.
That's why you just refer to him as Boban. That's
exactly.
It's easier to do it that way. So you guys thought I was mean by pointing out the size of his ears?
Yeah. It felt like an unnecessary shot.
Big guy. Big ears. Big guy.
Part
big
of
nose.
The
big
he's,
big
yeah.
everything.
All right. His movies.
All right. Well, if I may, it is against all human nature for a person that size to be that physically fit and run up and down a court with that many muscles. So he is an amazing physical specimen in every other way.
Carefully, he can hear you.
And also, his ears are unusually large by any measure, even if you were to argue that they were proportional. They are substantive ears. They are just substantive.
So then you could have picked any body part.
Yeah, it just didn't feel like relevant to the story. Like, it had nothing to do with the chicken.
At the time he said it, though, the only thing he could see were his ears. I mean, in Dan's defense.
It's frozen on the screen, and the ears are a little bit distracting. But, okay, fair enough that I probably shouldn't be body shaming a majestic and amazing athlete because he's got satellite dishes for ears.
You got another sideswipe there.
I thought ears were okay to make fun of, though. I thought ears... Their ears, like cauliflower ears.
Not anymore. No.
Yeah, not anymore?
Because woke.
Yep. Just not sure.
I thought the two safe spaces were JPP's firecracker fingers.
For me.
That's no longer in play. Yeah, okay, no. What else has been taken off? What else has been taken off the table? Because I know Rick Ross is going after, didn't he? Is he claiming that Drake got both an ab job and a nose job?
Those are the claims, Dano. He called them BBL Drizzy, even though BBL is something else. But yes, he claims he got a nose job and claims he got the, I don't know what surgery it is to like implant
what
abs.
What is that? Implants? So you can do like ab implants?
Yeah.
So he said he had 25% body fat, but like an 8-pack. I didn't know you could do that.
All the time you wasted doing sit-ups, Izzy.
Is it ab etching? This article in GQ says, welcome to the era of the fake six-pack.
Wow. Oh, wow.
Chiseled visible abs were once something you'd only see on genetically gifted gym rats, but these days a growing number of men are paying big money to have the surgeon do the chiseling for
Rick
them.
Rick Ross is claiming that Drake paid
$40,000
for that. That's what Rick Ross is claiming.
Huh. That's it? What happened to the days of just getting out in the gym, eating right, doing some core work, right? As a celebrity, you got a lot of time on your hands.
Right.
Do it the right way.
Chuck Norris is total gym. That's how you used to do it. Slide on a thing and pull body weight.
The Bowflex.
You fell for that too? Right.
And Peloton, of course.
Tony, Izzy,
not the ab roller.
What do you have for me? Jadakiss is mad because J. Cole is sitting out the beef, says beef is necessary for hip-hop. He says, Jadakiss says that he was really dismayed that J. Cole didn't use his skills to fire back. And now Rick Ross is entering the fray, and he's not fooling around, right? I thought he and Drake were friends.
They were. They've got a bunch of really good songs together, but it feels like right now there's been a lot of play back and forth on social media where there's been a leaked track of what could be a Drake response to Kendrick.
Some people think it's AI, right?
Some people think it's AI. We don't have 100% clarity on it because we don't know. Drake hasn't come out and said it. It hasn't dropped from OVO. Like, there's some nebulous stuff around it. But something got leaked. Then Rick Ross came out on his own and was like, I'm making this super personal. And then Ross dropped something. So there's a lot of back and forth right now. Drake put up a picture of Uma Thurman in Kill Bill where it's her against everybody in the army. And it feels like that right now in hip-hop, everybody's going at Drake.
I think the initial diss track response was thought to be AI. This one is official. It's Drake's. And this is what I love about this. All these beefs don't always like get me. This one got me from the very beginning because it was basically Kendrick just blowing up and saying, hey, you guys don't remember what hip hop is like. This is what hip hop is like. I'm supposed to say that I'm better than you. I'm better than everybody. And, you know, I might threaten violence. OK, and that's where J. Cole in the song that he's referencing here, that Kendrick is referencing, he literally said, guys are reading into my lyrics too much. I am not sneak dissing. If I hit you, you will know that I hit you. And what did Kendrick do? He said, nope, I consider that a sneak diss, and went nuclear. And now everybody's in on this. And this, and when J. Cole did his response, it felt like he was just sort of listing his resume, kind of like what Nas did, or what Jay-Z did to Nas. And that to me was boring. But now, when you're talking gossip, you're talking fake six-pack, you're talking Drake sort of throwing this little Easter egg out there to Kendrick and say, hey, I know stuff. I'm going to mention your wife's name. If you come back at me, wait till you hear the stuff that I throw out. And to me, it's a soap opera that is hip-hop. And right now, we're in the middle of it. Everybody is contributing, even 50-year-old Rick Ross.
It's cool because we talked about it last week and all the times that it elevates people's play, right? When you have this sort of versus, it's like, all right, how can I be better than X person? And it feels like Drake let out something that was really good. Like, I heard the track. I thought it was good. Drake is in a weird spot because he has to go back into his catalog and worry about this, the disses that he's done in the past, back-to-back with Meek Mill, where that became a banger and anthem for a ton of people. So it was like, how do you best yourself?
Update on the ab etching situation in this article. Apparently, this accusation about Drake has been out there for at least a couple years because someone wrote on one of his Instagrams that Carnage, who's a DJ, said, "You got fake ab surgery in Colombia. You ain't fooling anybody." And now the post is deleted. Huh.
It is time for Stu Gatz to share his game notes. No one in the media will tell you what happened better than my boy Stu.
Weekend observations brought to you by Miller Lite. Great taste, just 96 calories, available for delivery. Dan, we haven't seen him play since 2022. I, for one, am not concerned. He'll be 47 when the next NFL season starts. Again, not concerned. Many thought he'd never play again, even though me and Billy told you he would most definitely play again. Well, Dan, over the weekend, guess what?
He left the door open.
He said he's open for business and that he's still in NFL shape. And Dan, just like that, make no mistake about it, Tom Brady is back. Exciting.
It really is interesting to watch how he and Peyton Manning are going to compete for dollars the next 10 years. Peyton Manning just signed a 10-year deal with ESPN.
Yeah, yeah.
And Tom Brady's saying, yeah, but I don't have to do 10 years. I'll do a season of games, 17 games.
And play in a few.
maybe play in a few. He actually said if the call comes, it depends on who calls. He'll go out there and be a mercenary.
I love that the Patriots are an option now.
It would be great. They're not an option.
No, they're
were
an
one
option.
Of his options, yeah.
Yeah, they're definitely an option. Yeah. Belichick's no longer there.
We were running a scenario, Stu, last week when we heard the news where Tom was like getting out ahead and he was calling every team that Belichick was going to interview for and be like, by the way, if there's an opportunity at the end of the season, I might be interested. Bill can't be there, though.
But not if he's our coach.
Exactly right.
It's a reason to not hire him.
Mm-hmm. I mean. May explain some things.
Stu Gatz spent the weekend with Belichick.
Well, I didn't spend the weekend with Belichick. Belichick delivered the pregame speech to the Northwestern women's lacrosse team.
He spent the weekend with you.
You came in here and you said...
He was the third best coach on the field that day.
I was watching him. He was sitting under a tree on the phone. And
he was.
And you said he was the third best coach, that you were second.
Yes. Oh.
Who was Northwestern playing against? Were they fourth?
You're first. You were first. I assumed you were second. My
Kelly Amonte Hiller, one or two, depending on the day.
What?
Close second, me. She's one. Belichick third. Ohio State coach fourth.
I will say this. You assured us that if Belichick was there, he was going to be a guest on God Bless Football this week. So did that happen? Or?
Well, he was on the phone under a tree. I'm working on it. Tiger, shooting a career worst in a major tournament. Tiger, I told you not having sex wouldn't help.
Should have just had the sex, right? He finished
Finished
in last place.
Yeah.
He might have not made the cut, though.
Well, he made the cut.
I'm saying if he would have had sex, maybe he wouldn't have made
the cut. But Dan does his thing with last place, and technically he made the cut, though. Jordan Spieth would have loved to be there over the weekend.
Okay, but when they tallied up all the names at the end of the tournament, his was the last one on the leaderboard.
A lot of people like Lebatard laughing at Tiger Woods for his performance at Augusta. Luckily for Tiger, he can go home and laugh about it in one of his 5 green jackets. You, of course, know what that means, right, Dan?
What does that mean?
It means Tiger always has the last laugh. Laugh all you want. Go ahead. Chuckle fest. Ha, ha, ha. Last place. Can't walk. He's getting old. You know what he does? He puts on a green jacket and he laughs at you. Huh?
I wasn't laughing at him. Huh? I was just pointing out that he finished in last place.
The red with his new logo did not look right.
It's hard to wear red when you're plus 14.
I know, but a new Tiger logo instead of the Nike swoosh.
You're laughing at him. I didn't laugh at him.
Last laugh, Tiger, though.
You're laughing at him. I just heard you laugh.
Tiger's
at him.
Laugh is after his laugh, yeah. Dan.
It's always laugh. He hated playing with that guy on Sunday, right?
Oh, good story. Never thought I'd live long enough to see Knicks fans arguing on the last day of the season about whether or not they should get the 2 seed. What a time.
They should have lost that game. They really should have lost that
Insane
game.
Insane to go win that in overtime playing DiVincenzo 50-plus minutes.
He's
to
good.
Do it.
Yeah.
Nobody loves a regular season like Tom Thibodeau.
The Italian kid from Ohio.
Is Magic Cavs going to be played on like free TV or something? Like
NBA TV 2.
The rare moving day where just about everyone stayed put. The only guy that moved was Colin Morikawa. Know what the M in Morikawa stands for, Dan?
I do not.
Moving.
That was right there for
me. That would make sense, yes. Yeah. It was right there for me.
Got an update on Andrew McCutchen. Still playing. He's a Pirate. 300 homers. Kutch. Hall of Famer?
He made the Pirates relevant. In this era.
Do they call him Kutch?
Yes.
The Pirates aren't relevant in this era, though.
But if you were to name a Pirate, he would be the one.
That's true. For the last, like, 20 years.
That should get
you
into the hall.
Even when he wasn't a Pirate for a few years.
Do they call him Kutch, though?
They do, yes.
Of course. Yeah, everyone knows that. The Sunday night after the Masters ends makes me sad. Top 5 saddest Sundays of the year. Number 5. The last Sunday of summer break. Number 4, Masters Sunday. Number 3, the last Sunday after the Christmas, New Year's holidays. Number 2, Super Bowl Sunday. And number 1, for my poor wife, Abby, every Sunday.
So you're just doing Sunday night, though, right? Because the Super Bowl, the day of the Super Bowl, you're fine. It's just
I get sad. No, the whole week I'm sad because conference championship games are done. You have one lonely football game left.
You're sad all of Radio Row week?
Yeah, the whole week.
Because you wake up on Masters Sunday just sad?
Yes. Because I'm not going to see the thing I love so much for another year. It makes me sad.
Don't smile because it's going to be over soon. Smile because it's not happened yet.
That's how you say it.
I think
it.
That's the saying.
That is exactly.
We don't know the rest of it. Just continue.
Baseball and your unwritten rules. Get over yourselves. Top prospect, Jackson Holliday, is 1-for-15 to start his career. Hey, Jackson, do it in the majors. If you like a heart attack with your save, Craig Kimbrell is your guy. It's never easy. Also a tough name. Golden State Warriors, the rare win or blow up the team game. A lot on the line. Boston, New York, Cleveland, Orlando, Indiana, Philadelphia, Oklahoma City, Minnesota, LA Clippers, Dallas, Phoenix, all of you, do it in the postseason.
Wow.
Dan, we were so close. I believe the closest we've ever been to a Masters Champions dinner menu that included gefilte fish.
Is it gefilte? I thought it was gefilte. I don't know how
tomato,
to
tomato.
It doesn't matter. It's always funny.
Okay. It is a funny phrase. Agreed.
Observations we were so close to having if Max Homa won the Masters. Dan, you know what the B in Butler Cabin stands for?
I do not.
It stands for brisket. Dan, you know what the M in Masters stands for? Meshuggah. Man, Max.
Thought you were going to go for a matzo ball soup.
The start of 60 Minutes. The rare jump scene that you know is coming and still gets you every single time. It was jump scare, not scene.
The joke doesn't work if you don't say
no,
it
I get
correctly.
It.
Thank you, Izzy. Appreciate it. The Atlantic having an article titled "Democracy Dies Behind a Paywall." Behind a paywall. The Atlantic. The Stugats is so very strong in you. Cavs, Magic, first round matchup. If this series was a movie, it would go straight to DVD. They say the Masters doesn't start until the back nine on Sunday. Scottie Scheffler didn't get that message. Seth Davis tweeting that he and Mark Pope can go line for line at reciting Hamilton lyrics is the last thing I'd want to see if I'm a Kentucky fan. I want my coach to be too busy that he's never seen Hamilton. I mean, seriously, what is he doing? You think Calipari has seen it?
The only Hamilton I want is Leonard.
Eight golfers shot under par over the weekend. Do you know who wins the Masters every year, Dan? Augusta. I didn't give you a chance there. The only thing crazier than Scottie Scheffler winning two Masters before turning 28 is the fact that Scottie Scheffler is only 27.
28, yeah. He doesn't. On, he does look 48. He does look older.
The Dodgers fan that threw back a fake home run ball while keeping the real home run ball. How do you play, man?
And then doing interviews afterward.
A nominee.
I would have been fine with them just turning down the broadcast and just interviewing him for the rest of the game.
Mm-hmm. A nominee for the least surprising headline of the year. An agency led by Bad Bunny is facing sanctions.
Whoa.
What happened?
Why do you think Bad Bunny?
What did Bad Bunny ever do to you?
Why did Bad Bunny do to deserve sanctions?
It wasn't surprising.
What's the deal with that?
It's not Good Bunny, it's Bad Bunny. Yeah.
Okay. Conejo Malo.
Bad Bunny.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. John Rahm looks like he's having difficulty living inside his own skin. He does. John, LIV wasn't made for you. It was made for guys who don't give a shit. Guys who are past their primes. Guys that have gambling debts. Or, if you're Phil Mickelson, all of the above. Lefty. Death. Taxes. And Tommy Fleetwood. In contention Sunday at Augusta. The things you do driving around the Midwest on a gummy in the passenger seat. Top five athletes. That Kanota rock band. OLI. John Jett. ML Carr, Razor Ramon.
I'm sorry, what? So what are those? What's
they
happening?
They Kanota rock band, Tommy Fleetwood.
Okay, but what are the, Joan Jett or Benny and the Jets?
Joan Jett, what do you mean?
I don't know.
And the Jets, a song.
John Jett sounds like Joan Jett. She's a rocker.
Yes, Tommy Fleetwood, Fleetwood Mac.
Okay, sorry.
Number five, Kareem Rush. Number four, Max Crosby, Kenny Stills, Steve Nash, and Vince Young.
Wow. Okay, all of them. All right, nicely
Thank
done.
Thank you, everyone.
That one got an ovation back
that's
here.
Pretty good. That's pretty good.
Number three, Marty Fish. Number two, David Boston. Number one, Johan Santana.
Santana Band.
Sorry. Absolutely, is Dan. Absolutely,
I
mean, Dan.
I
Come
think
on,
of Santana
man.
As an individual. No,
Carlos
artist.
Santana, the individual. Santana, the band built around him.
So upset at you.
I think of Santana as an individual, not as a band. What do you want me to tell you?
I don't know.
The Santana, Carlos Santana is in the Hall of Fame, isn't he? The whole band is.
Carlos Santana, the first baseman?
You think Johan did enough, huh? Heat Sixers. The Rare lose or go to the Mecca game. John Rahm, you took $600 million smeared in blood. Do me a favor. Spare me your outrage about the playing conditions at Augusta. Hey, John, know what $6 million buys you? Me never caring about anything you ever have to say again. Vern Lundquist, it's been an honor listening to you, sir. Tip of the cap.
Wow. A sir, an honor, and a tip of the cap. The holy trinity for a guy who looks like a soap bubble.
Is Santana
first
up
what are you doing, Dan? What's going on?
That's a looks-like tournament. No, that is that's a seed he got in our tournament one time. Vern Lundquist looks like a soap bubble.
This is why Billy canceled looks like, because you're a little offensive.
A lot of body shaming.
It looks like a soap bubble. I don't, what do you want me to tell you?
Boban's listening.
Boban or Bojan?
Bench is cleared in Dodgers Padres. Why do the benches clear in baseball? Like, do you think the guys in the bullpen jog in thinking, what the hell are we doing here? Honestly, it's a waste of a jog. No one's going to fight. Speaking of Hellhart Bryles, Dan, those are the weekend observations.
This show has enjoyed over the last year making fun of Joe Cronin and the Portland Trailblazers. Basically, this entire Trailblazers season has existed for us in Miami only as a thing to pay attention to mock. And yesterday, a Portland Trailblazer named Delano Banton not only, Stugatz, went 0 for 15 from 3.
Right. Wow.
Which is damn hard to do.
It's amazing.
But then I would guess, without knowing any other details other than he was ejected for a flagrant 2, I'm going to go ahead and say frustration foul. I didn't watch anything. They were down by 30. I see him leaving the arena. I'm like, how does he feel about himself? Walking back to the locker room, flagrant 2, I'm ejected. Does he know he's gone 0 for 15? Surely he knows he hasn't made a 3. Surely he knows he's having a bad day. But does he know he's missed 15 of them and that's never happened before?
I'm not certain if he knows the exact number, but he knows he missed a lot. Like, he definitely knows that.
Shooters always know they're going to make the next one. So you don't count the ones behind you. You count the ones in front of you.
Is he a shooter? 31% from 3?
Well, you know how the shooter's mentality is.
He was 2 for 10 from 3 the night before.
No, he's 4 for his last 34 or something from 3. But Tony's right. Tim Hardaway, I asked him one time, and what were you thinking when you were 0 for 17 that I was about to be 1 for 18? Like, that's what I was
shooter's
thinking.
Mentality. You're always going to make the next one, Dan. That's the thing. That's the allure of the shooter is like, this next one, you know what it is? I fixed my form. Maybe my elbow was a little too out. Maybe my legs weren't you know, facing the rim.
Can you have a shooter's mentality in the NBA if your name is Delano Banton? That's my only question.
He was 6 of 11 from 2. I mean,
best part is that he's one of the bright spots of the Blazers season. Genuinely.
Is he named after FDR?
Well, this is D-A-L-N-A-N-O. Wow, that was Delano Chris Lebo reaching.
No, that, you didn't spell that right.
D-A-L-A-N-O.
Do your Boban bit again.
Boban, Bojan, Bogdan, you know? That was really funny, right?
Stugatz, do you think ESPN is about to do a 30 for 30 on Stuart Scott? And I mentioned earlier, I am super interested to see what the deal is that Peyton Manning has with Omaha Productions and ESPN, because it was reported that Peyton Manning and Eli are just doing the Manning cast, but they signed a content deal. They're going to be making stuff for ESPN. ESPN is going to start outsourcing some stuff and using people who don't necessarily work inside the company to make things for them, but they're making a 30 for 30 on Stuart Scott, and I'm genuinely curious whether they're going to tackle how hard people in that building made it on Stuart Scott. Like, I'm genuinely curious whether they're just going to turn it into a celebration of Stuart
Scott. Tell the whole story.
Or whether they're going to examine, because Stuart Scott and the people who care about Stuart Scott will tell you that there were a whole lot of people playing defense against his general style when it came on that made that not popular, but deeply unpleasant. You're talking about pre-social media and all this stuff that you now see that is out in the open that can't be missed in terms of racial divisions. He was coming to the Church of Sports, and he was doing it in a way that was black. And we weren't used to consuming it that way, and he was treated. Anyone who went through that time with Stuart Scott will tell you that he was an amazing pioneer, at least in part because of how hard he had it inside of that building from people who were supposed to be supporters.
Can I take a cannonball on this? I still work for ESPN.
Oh, I'm just curious. Like,
I'm trying to get back there.
Can you even tell that story correctly? Can you even tell that story correctly? If he is, that's true. Like,
his, ranking quarterbacks, baby.
His greatest bummer of everything of the last 4 years is that he's not on the lacrosse games for ESPN anymore.
I miss those, man.
doing a lacrosse on ESPN3. No, but I'm genuinely curious whether or not you can tell the story without that part. Like, it can be an homage and also celebrate him all the more because he had to overcome a time.
I'd be very surprised if it's anything but a celebration of Stuart Scott's career. I'd be very surprised. It's airing on ESPN. ESPN is involved in the production of this movie. I'd be surprised if ESPN's going to bring that onto themselves.
Because he had his own autobiography that came out before he passed away that delved into a little bit of this stuff, I would think because it's already out there and it wouldn't be something that's being discovered for the first time, maybe they'd be willing to delve into it a little bit. But like you guys said, I would imagine this is mostly just a celebration of the innovation that he had as a SportsCenter anchor.
You guys have heard me talk before. We're in the documentary business. We will be having between 10 and 20 documentaries coming out in the next couple of years. And one of the lanes that we have that I think is getting harder and harder to occupy is that we don't have to worry about corporate dilutions because of who we're teaming up with so that we can tell the most honest version of a story. I saw here recently, Stugatz, and I was surprised by this, and I don't know what's happening here. I don't think that Apple has had the impact that some of the other streamers have had outside of Ted Lasso. So they did an exceptional documentary on the Patriots dynasty. It's 10 parts. There is no disputing that there was stuff in there that most people have not heard, and there is no disputing that generally we're interested in conquering dynasties. You put Tom Brady in it, you put Bill Belichick in it, you put friction in it. At the end of it, you make it seem a bit like a character assassination of Belichick, where he gets hit especially hard in a way that makes you think Bob Kraft is the one editing that thing. But it seems to have had no resonance. It's a 10-part series over years, done for years over the team that has dominated America's most popular sport and is part of the reason that it is America's most popular sport, because when it started as a dynasty, it was not yet America's most popular sport. The fact that that was covered that well on Apple, and our viewing habits are so fractured, it doesn't seem like it made much of an impact, except in New England, where they were reporting some of the details that made it feel like the end of that documentary was a hatchet job that just put everything on the desk of Belichick.
The most damning part to me was the Malcolm Butler discussion, right? And the implication that he did that for a personal reason and then just left it there for, I guess, other people to figure out after the doc. And that would have been ridiculously damning for Bill Belichick. And that, to me, was the one spot where I said, there's no way he was in agreement. Like, he was probably forced to sit in that seat because this makes him look terrible. But I haven't seen a follow-up to that.
But I'm interested in where Dan is headed with this conversation from the standpoint, that's normally something I would seek out. I would want to watch, and for whatever reason, I didn't on this one.
Well, do you have Apple?
I do have Apple. I don't know how to access Apple, though. I mean, but I...
Okay. The thing that's happening here, Netflix...
I liked it better when just, boom, it was on ESPN. There it is. I turn on
that
the TV.
That does make it easy.
Boom!
Yes. That is how a lot of people consume this stuff, but viewing habits are changing.
I mentioned this on Mystery Creator a few weeks ago, and I think this puts me in, like, an older demographic, but I really miss the days of just channel surfing. Yeah. And even though I have YouTube TV and it has like a channel guide that you can search, like surf through, I don't do it as much anymore, except for last night after the Masters, Lehman put on Rudy because it was on some random channel. And I was like, man,
TBS.
The good old days, like the 90s all over again, like you were saying, Dan. It was great. We don't channel surf anymore, and it's a shame.
Yesterday, I was channel surfing to a sense in that, like, it gave me an option of a show I've never heard of. I was going through, and then it said, like, for you, Stugatz, you're going to love this show. It's from 2023. It's called Greatest Heist with Pierce Brosnan.
Wow.
It's on History Channel.
Wow. Oh, I'm locked in.
That part, the little H on the History Channel really kind of takes away from it a little bit, but Greatest Heist with Pierce Brosnan.
That's, Billy, I feel like I'm never, if Netflix or Hulu owns the catalog for Greatest Heist, I'm never going on those streamer apps and hitting it. That's a show for channel surfing. Same with Air Disasters.
Also, Greatest Heist, I'm interested in. With Pierce Brosnan, not missing.
Did they talk about the most recent heist, by the way?
What's that?
The Easter heist. You guys hear about that or no?
No.
It was it's like one of the biggest heists in American history. They did it over Easter weekend. They stole like $3 million. Yes. Yeah. Oh. And then they came back to work after Easter.
$3 million. Child's Play. Episode 1 of Greatest Heist.
In cash.
Over $100 million.
In cash.
At the time, now, $500 million. In diamonds.
That's a crazy heist.
America is in unprecedented territory. For the first time, a former United States president faces criminal charges in court. In one corner, a sleazy, slutty prostitute with no shame or credibility. In the other, Stormy Daniels. Donald Trump faces charges that he paid $130,000 in hush money to a porn star. No former president has ever stood trial before. This is the first of four criminal trials Donald Trump faces.
It's very serious. Like, he's the voice actor of a generation. He does like 21 voices on The Simpsons, and that's how we use him to do that. Eli Mistal is with us. He's a justice correspondent for The Nation. He's the author of Allow Me to Retort, A Black Guy's Guide to the Constitution. It's been too long since I've talked to him. His perspective and his viewpoint is necessary in these divided times. He's also the only person in the history of this show to do it with an Afro pick. Thank you for joining us, Eli. I appreciate the time. What do you find most absurd about both today and just the last, I'm going to say, 8 years of chaos?
There are three main witnesses in the trial that we're about to see, right? One is a former president of the United States. One is a low-rent fixer from the bridge and tunnel crowd who's already been to jail for lying to the FBI. And the third is an adult film actress. And it's the president with the least amount of credibility in the room. Like, that's the thing that always kind of gets me, right? It's the actual president of the United States, which is the lowest hanging, sleaziest fruit in the entire room when put next to a fixer and an adult film star. That's kind of amazing. But it's where we are, because we know what happened here, right? Again, Michael Cohen went to jail for lying. So when he decided to tell the truth he told was that Trump slept with Stormy Daniels and paid him $130,000 to pay her to cover it up, right? That's fact, according to the FBI, who again jailed Cohen for lying about it in the first place. Then we have Stormy Daniels, who has done nothing but tell the truth. I mean, she might be able to lie to the camera for a living, but she doesn't lie about who she lays with, right? She ain't told a single falsehood in this entire story. So she knows who she slept with. She knows exactly the kinds of mushrooms that she's been dealing. She knows how much money she got, right? So the two people who haven't lied are not the president. And that's always amazing to me.
What do you expect to see today and the rest of the time in this trial? Because a criminal trial is different from some of his other courtroom shenanigans.
It's not, because he's white. So it's not like it. Like, I expect to see chaos because Trump brings chaos, right? Look, if it was any other defendant, given his repeated violations of court orders and gag orders and propriety. And if it was any other defendant, Trump would be rolled into that courtroom on the Hannibal Lecter gurney, right? Just with the face mask, wouldn't be able to say anything because of his constant repeated lies and falsehoods, right? But he's Trump. He's white. He's rich. So they ain't going to do that. They ain't going to wheel him in on the Hannibal Lecter gurney. They're going to let him walk into the courthouse, spew his ridiculousness, sit there for 6 hours where nobody gets to know because there are no cameras in this courtroom for reasons passing understanding. So nobody gets to see it actually happen. Then he's going to walk out of the courtroom. He's going to lie about it some more. He's going to, oh, it was unfair. And the judge's daughter hates me. And he's going to do the whole, it's going to be circus, the circus for 6 weeks because that's all Trump knows how to do, right? When you're a carnival barker, every problem looks like a clown. And that's what Trump is. Like, he's just a clown and he's able to bring clownishness to anything he touches. You know, Rick Wilson says everything Trump touches dies. That's true. But it's also everything Trump touches is sullied, right? Everything Trump touches is lessened. And that's what this trial is going to be like, just like all of his other ones.
What about consequences?
All right, so here's the thing. Like, obviously, I hate the man, and I wish nothing but bad things for him for the rest of his life. But he's accused of falsifying business records, which he, I think, clearly did. I think the prosecution will show that he reimbursed himself illegally and fraudulently for the hush money payments. But the thing is, we don't normally put people in jail for this kind of business fraud when it's their first time offense. And calling Trump a first time offender hurts me like in my soul. Like, I don't like that reality that we live in. But he is technically a 76-year-old first time offender. And we generally do not put people in jail, 76-year-old people in jail for a first time offense of falsifying business records. Not saying that he couldn't go to jail, but I'm saying that, just put it like this, if he went to jail behind these charges, that would be extreme. And Trump always, you know, uses the justice system in the other way. He always gets the most lenient version of justice, not the harshest version of justice, right? Another way of putting it is, you'd have to be black to go to jail behind these charges, right? And whatever Trump is, he ain't black. And so it's unlikely that he will face actual jail time behind this case.
How important is jury selection? What happens if Trump gets one MAGA fan on the jury?
And then he wins. Then he wins. It's the whole ball game, right? Like, I've always thought about the Trump trial kind of like the Hugh Freeze scandal, right? Like, what's important here? Like, oh, I'm gonna call all these prostitutes. Well, yeah, it's not really bad to call them. What's bad is that you're on the Ole Miss plane while you're calling the prostitutes. Like, that's what got Freeze. Now imagine you're trying to hold Freeze accountable, and somebody on the committee is a booster, right, of Ole Miss. Somebody, or now you're trying to hold Freeze accountable years later, and somebody on the committee is a booster of Auburn. Like, what happens then, right? And that's where we are with the jury selection. It only takes one MAGA cultist, and as much as New York City has this reputation of being, you know, super liberal, it's not, right? I mean, Eric Adams is in charge, technically, right? Like, we got idiots here, too. And so it just takes one inserted into the jury to hang the jury because it's a criminal case and you need unanimous consent. I will say, and I said this on television last night, like, as much as I think the jury selection is the entire ballgame, I'm not completely hopeless here, right? Because the goal of jury selection is not to find 12 people who don't have an opinion about Trump. That's impossible. Everybody's got an opinion about Trump. The goal is to find 12 people who are willing to put their opinions about Trump to the side long enough to hear the evidence presented at trial, right? And to give that evidence the fair shake as opposed to their preconceived notions about Trump. Now, personally, I could not do it, right? If I was in the jury pool, I'd be like, no, you have to exclude me. I hate the man. Get me out of this pool. Like, I can't be impartial about this man. Are there 12 people in New York City, which has quite a few people who can, in good faith, treat this man impartially, I think there's a chance. I think there's a chance that you find those 12 people. Obviously, Trump's defense team will be looking for. I mean, they'll have their secret codes and like, are you wearing the trucker hat underneath your, suit? Like, they'll be trying to find out who's actually MAGA and insert that person on the jury. That's what the defense is looking for. And if they get one or two of those people, that's it. It's ball game. But the prosecution and the judge, the jury questionnaire, I think, is very good. There's a chance that you could get a fair jury.
That goal seems unattainable to me, Ellie. It just seems like it seems nearly impossible. You know what? It seems unattainable to me that you're going to find 12 people.
I mean, the other thing, Stu, though, is that the case is really simple, right? Like, there's not a lot, it's not a hard case to prove, right? Did you have sex with this woman? Yes. Did you pay her? Yes. Did you lie about why you paid her? Yes. Did you know you were lying while you were doing it? That's kind of the, yeah, right? So, like, to rule for an acquittal, you've got to not just be like a Trump supporter in the way that, like, I don't know, Chris Sununu is, right? You can't be the Susan Collins, like, Trump has learned his lesson, Trump support. Like, you've got to be like dyed in the wool Lindsey Graham, like, I live inside Trump's crevices, like, Trump supporter in order to acquit him. And again, they could find that person, but like, I haven't completely lost hope that that person gets excluded.
Do you think Trump will testify?
I mean, he'll want to. He'll say he'll want to, because he thinks everything's a show, and he has that performer sense that if I could just razzle dazzle him, I can get off. The problem is that when you put him on the stand, all of his prior lies and bad acts come out, right? Like, right now, what's happening, like, while we're on air, is that the trial, right now, they're making evidentiary decisions in the trial. Does the Karen McDougal story come in? Because remember, Stormy Daniels ain't the only person that he had sex with outside the bonds of his marriage, right? So does that story come in? Does the National Choir Inquirer catch and kill stories, do those come in? Does the Access Hollywood tape come in? Do we have to play that to the jury? And when Trump gets on, the judge is going to make those decisions today. But when Trump gets on the stand, he can talk himself into introducing further bad evidence against him. So if I'm his lawyer, I'm doing everything I can to keep that man, again, gurneyed and ball gagged and in the chair. Whether Trump is able to overcome that, I can't know. He's, the client gets to decide, and Trump likes the camera. The fact that there are no cameras in this courtroom, I think, lessens the chance that Trump testifies. Honestly, if there were cameras there, I think he would use it as a campaign ad. Without the cameras there, I think cooler legal heads will prevail, but you never know with this guy.
Ellie, I have a pitch that I'm interested in seeing if you want to get in on. Maybe you come on as a consultant or whatever. We have Hollywood friends we can pitch this to. It's a sitcom. Maybe you talk to some people at NBC. It's called White House Arrest. Ooh. And what happens is you have either a former president or current president. They go to trial. They're found guilty. And because of age or because of severity of the crimes, they get house arrest. But it's at the White House.
Wow.
So they can't leave.
Yes. Yes.
White House arrest.
Yes.
Okay, so first of all, constitutionally, just to be clear, there is nothing that prevents a person who has been convicted of a crime or is currently serving time for a crime from being president. That's just not something the white enslavers who wrote the Constitution decided to put in there. Right? No, you could be in jail and be president, right? So, like, that, just as a legal matter, your pitch does pass the smell test. It's possible for that to happen. I would argue, though, that I don't want to get
so you
into
in or not
trouble,
right? That's,
like,
really
let's also remember something. Trump is the first president to be prosecuted because other criminal ass presidents in the past have not been held accountable for their actions, right? Like, there are some other presidents that we could have prosecuted if we were serious about this democracy in times before, just to be clear, right? So, like, I think the reason why it's so important to prosecute Trump for his crimes, not just this one, but the ones that Jack Smith is working on and all the rest, is that it's the only limiting factor we have to stop future presidents from doing future crime, right? If Trump's, like, take Trump's immunity argument. If you were just, if you becoming president makes you immune, not only for the things you do as president, but everything you do for the rest of your life, you know, that's a principle that's not just going to apply to Trump. It's going to apply to every president going forward. And that's a terrible precedent because presidents are already fundamentally dangerous to democracy and democratic self-government.
Well, I mean, we're thinking like 22 minutes, maybe Ted right. Danson, not that
serious. Half track.
Sounds yeah. like you're out. I mean,
I'm gonna read you 10 Donald Trump facts, and I want you to pick either the best or the worst one, however it is. Just 10 facts. Are you ready?
Okay.
Donald Trump once said that wind turbines cause cancer. Donald Trump once claimed that household bleach could cure COVID in, quote, 1 minute. Donald Trump founded a fake university. Donald Trump has been accused of sexual misconduct by at least 26 women since the 1970s. Donald Trump called for the execution of 5 wrongfully imprisoned teenagers. Donald Trump oversaw a foundation that misused donations for self-dealing while failing to pay victims of 9/11. Donald Trump called the pandemic that killed 1.1 million Americans a hoax. Donald Trump oversaw an agriculture department that banned the phrase climate change. Donald Trump said that John McCain was not a war hero. Donald Trump shared highly classified information with the foreign minister of Russia.
The wind turbines is always the dumbest. Like, it's just always so, like, it's the level of, like, not knowing of things to say that always, like, jumps off the page. But obviously, I gotta go with the 26 women that he sexually assaulted, some of whom he has been accused of raping. Like, that, like, it, joking aside, right? Dude is Bill Cosby out here when it comes to how he treats women, and it's just like we just accept it, like we just, it just rolls off the tongue, right? It's just, oh, also they're 20. It's never, it's not ever one, right? It's never just E. Jean Carroll, it's never just Stormy. It's all these women that he has molested, assaulted, and in some cases raped, and it doesn't matter to Christians. I mean, again, with the Hugh Freeze. Who rehabilitated Hugh Freeze? Was it Auburn? No, it was Liberty. It was the Christian university that was like, get that escort man back in here. Yeah, we got to win some football games. Like, it's the Christians that are okay with this. And it's, so wind turbines, obviously the worst.
Always great. Thank you.
In his defense, I did the bleach thing and it worked. I mean.
How do you think I got my hair like this? I was trying to cure COVID. My hair ended up like this.
Thank you, Ellie.
If you think of all the germs, you could have gotten worms. Think of D-Wade if he saw you being rude, scarfing down your food. Or if he heard you fart in the studio that day. Once more, the chips you chose to chew in open bag would do. So why were you eating your hand? And it's time to reprimand. To think you do it all the time, I'll never look the same at you. Cause it was in so deep, you swallowed a knuckle or two. Did you have to lick your finger?
How do you imagine, Stugatz, that the South Carolina women's basketball team experienced Caitlin Clark on Saturday Night Live?
Probably not well. It's still a great thing that she appeared there. It's great that the exposure for the women's game, but probably like, hey, why aren't we on Saturday Night Live?
I would imagine that is what they're thinking. I wanted to clean something up from earlier in the show as well. You guys mentioned associating Pierce Brosnan with heists. I do too, but outside of the Thomas Crown Affair.
Great movie.
Has there been another heist movie that Pierce Brosnan has done that you associate Pierce Brosnan? Because I, too, associate him with the idea of being someone who hosts a heist show. But The Italian Job was a heist, and it was not – I don't think that Pierce Brosnan – I feel like De Niro has done more of those than Pierce Brosnan has.
I feel like physically Pierce Brosnan looks like a guy – that, did I say his name wrong?
Who is that?
I think you put D in his last name.
I probably
somewhere.
Did, but he seems like a guy that would, he would lead a group of people into a heist. He does. He does.
He was in a movie called After the Sunset, which was great, where some diamonds are
it was
thefted
great?
There. Yeah, oh, it was great.
What's the score on that?
Was it not?
Just, I can't see it there.
The Rotten Tomatoes score?
Rotten Tomatoes score. It's right there on the bottom.
So I don't know.
Right there to the right,
Billy. I need to watch The Thomas Crown Affair. I still haven't seen
it. So good. Great scene.
When I think of Pierce Brosnan, there's this... Internet TV critic Brian Grubb, his whole bit is every time there's a heist, he reposts it with a picture of Pierce Brosnan just looking hot in like some nice white linen pants. So I think of Pierce Brosnan whenever I think of heists.
Guys,
and he's a Bond.
I have something to ask you because I don't think that I can pull this off, but I have to pull this off. I have a wedding that I'm attending in Mexico in the summer on the beach, and it is prime
Elo time.
Linen time, but I'm not a linen guy.
Oof. Everybody's a linen guy. You got to go in with the swagger of being a linen guy.
That's the thing. I feel like I have to embrace the linens, and this entire trip, destination wedding, it has to be a lot of linens, but I don't have any linens right now, and I'm not sure that I'm about the linen
I'll take you to my
life.
Spot. I'll take you to my spot.
Izzy, what are you shaking your head about?
I mean, I think linens are a little odd, right? So you're talking the middle of the summer in Mexico, and yes, like it's going to be hot, so you want cool clothing, but you sweat in that. You might get that stuff sticking to you. It might become see-through at some point. It's going to be very, it's kind of gross.
Well, if I learned anything at working at Victoria's Secret, you wear nude-colored underwear when you're wearing white.
That's what you learned.
A great
huh?
lesson for you to learn from Victoria's Secret.
Yes. Am I wrong?
I don't know. Do you have any nude?
I didn't work
colored,
there.
Do you have any nude-colored underwear?
I'm just
not,
picturing him giving this advice
not as
to
of yet.
Other women.
I also knew how to measure, but we weren't allowed to do that. Huh. That would lead to problems.
Interesting.
Explain.
You didn't
How do you do it?
Measure?
Yeah.
You have to. You take the measuring tape. You go. You measure over the top first. And then you go and you measure, you know, center, and then the difference, and you know, it's a whole thing.
But you never got the opportunity.
No.
Not allowed.
No one's, yeah.
You didn't answer the question of what the rating was, Rotten Tomatoes rating on After the Sunset, which you described.
Rotten
as a
Tomatoes,
great
we all know,
movie.
Big political place.
I'm not going to take a quiz on what the Rotten Tomatoes rating is.
Because there's the critics score, which we all know critics can be bought, and that's
it looks
been
like
proven.
18%.
That's
from
the
back
critic.
Here.
That's the critics.
Don't
the
care.
Audience score 52.
All right.
I'm telling you.
Coin toss.
Mm-hmm. I think you'll enjoy a nice crisp linen suit.
Oh,
and you know who knows
suit? No.
His
linen?
No linen suit. Absolutely not linen suit.
Not wearing a suit?
On
no.
the beach?
On the beach?
No chance.
Crazy.
I was arguing that I
should
be...
I assumed
it
was a formal wedding, but I mean... I
no,
guess
it's the beach. Nothing's
that's
formal. A whole other thing that has led to problems.
Is it beach cocktail or like casual beach or whatever the dress code is?
There's this expectation that I'm to dress nice outdoors on the beach part, and then I'm to change to go to the reception and dress differently. And I said... Friends, this is on the beach. I will be wearing shorts. And I was quickly told, no, you will not.
Oh, my God. Please wear a linen seersucker or, like, shorts with, like, a blazer. Oh, my God, Billy.
I'm getting all kinds of mixed signals because they're also saying, you know, either barefoot or sandals. I'm like, barefoot or sandals is shorts. I'm not wearing pants, but they're telling me I have to wear pants.
You got to wear pants. It's a remember, what we're missing here is we're looking at the different levels of linen, right? Seersucker linen is not Mexico linen. Right,
but
Caribbean
it would look
linen
so funny
is totally
if Billy
different.
Wore
what's
it?
Mexico linen?
Mexico linen is like a nice cut-off shirt, right? Not full way, not all the way down, not a long sleeve shirt, a regular shirt, button, couple buttons down. You're in Mexico, you're showing a little bit of a chest.
Mm.
I was gifted this shirt with parrots on it, and I was told there's no circumstance in which I can wear that to
wear
the wedding.
Wear the parrots.
How about this? You're traveling to Mexico. It's costly. You need a passport. You're going to a different country. It's on a beach. It's going to be 95 degrees. I'll wear what I want. How's that sound? Shorts, flip-flops, whatever I want, I'm going to wear it.
Put it on the poll, please, Juju at Lebitard Show. Is an 18 critic score and 52 audience score a coin toss?
50-50. Can we all look? I've seen it already. I'm happy to do this if the class wants to do it. Let's all watch After the Sunset tonight.
Down.
And then we can come back and discuss tomorrow.
Before or after the WNBA draft.
It's fun. It's a fun little flick. How about we two screen it?
Where is it? Where do they have it?
Ooh. I'd imagine there's a lot of downtime in the WNBA draft, like most drafts, right?
Yeah, commercial breaks.
What would it take? What would it take to trade for the number one pick? There's no circumstance in which a team
you
would,
don't have enough.
There's, you, no, there's, nobody no, has there's enough. Not enough.
That's
right?
A great sports
nobody,
topic.
Nobody has enough.
What who has it, the number one pick?
What would it take? Oh, Indiana. What would it take?
Sorry, I was asking. I'm trying to get into it. I mean,
we've said it like a lot.
We've said it on this show. In front
I confused
of you so many
Iowa
times.
With Indiana.
Yeah. Yeah. Just, same market.
Did you watch the Michael Che thing with Caitlin Clark this week? Okay. Well, then you would have seen it on that too.
Yeah, I didn't watch it.
She made a joke about Indiana fever sounding like an STD.
Let's get some
which
real.
Which I've always thought, by the way. I'm glad someone finally said it.
Let's get some real basketball knowledge here.
Sounds like something you get at Little Five. Sorry, Dan.
From Izzy, Stan Van Gundy says that Luka Doncic is the greatest offensive player in NBA history. I don't find Stan to be prone to hyperbole. I don't find Stan to be prisoner of the moment. Stan is watching a history of basketball, and he is saying that the most efficient, more efficient than 2018, Harden, Michael Jordan, any of them, that Luka Doncic is the best offensive player he's ever seen. I wanted to argue, but the same way I wanted to argue with Mark Jackson when he initially said that Steph Curry and Klay Thompson were the best shooting backcourt of all time, and then I'm like, it's a little hard to argue because what he's saying, I mean, we can split hairs, but what he's saying, when I say that we're watching once in a lifetime players, nine of them in the NBA right now, I don't think I have it wrong.
Did you ask Stan if he's seen Michael Jordan?
Stugatz did.
I did, yeah.
Just making sure. No, I heard that.
That's how I argue.
Here's the thing about Luka, and until Stan said that, I hadn't really had this thought. But I was thinking about how you defend Luka, and I literally said, well, just start standing next to him when he starts his shooting. And I'm like, how ridiculous would you look as a defender if you just, oh, he's starting his shooting motion. Let me run next to him so that maybe I can block. It's when you have to think that way, it tells you the guy is ridiculously unstoppable. There was a point in his rookie season where I thought, oh, that jumper, it's gonna fall off. It's not going to be consistent. It's just gotten better and better. It's a little flick of the wrist, and he can fade away in any direction. Oh, and by the way, if you get him going that way, he can just hit a three-point finger roll. And just, it's amazing the shots this guy hits. They look like trick shots.
Izzy, I don't know if you'll agree with me here. He looks like the most effortless scorer. Yeah. And I think that's what differentiates kind of like guys you see going hard and their scores. And it's like, oh, yeah, he can get to the hoop whenever he wants. Luka gets to the hoop and it looks easy. Everything looks like he's
because
kind of
in slow
motion.
Because he doesn't have to blow by you because he's so big. It's a combination of everything, right? Because when we talk about offensive players, we're talking about skill set, right? Because you give me you tell me Shaq in his prime, that's a great offensive player. He only has one necessary move, but he's a great offensive player. What Luka does, he has the size. Whatever you try to take away from him, he has a counter for every single thing. When Kyrie Irving considers himself, you know, the savant, right? He knows basketball. He's on a different level. When he gives you props, like he did to Kevin Durant, you know, oh, that's the only guy who can do what I do when he was with the Brooklyn Nets. When he gives Luka props, and when you see him sort of the shine, like glow when Luka does some amazing stuff. When you're impressing Kyrie Irving, I mean, that means you are on the top level of NBA skill people, like of all time.
Kyrie Irving, who by consensus, everyone seems to say is the best ball handler in the history of the sport. Like it doesn't.
There's no question about it.
It just doesn't seem like there's even a second place.
Did you see Isaiah Thomas?
When you watch Kyrie in person, it's sort of like those people who are so fast that it looks like their feet aren't hitting the ground the way he dribbles the basketball, where it's just from one space to another before you've even processed it in your mind. And with the Mavericks, I mean, the way that they handle their pregame shots, like Luka is not preparing at all for the game.
He's,
no,
he's
just shooting the
around.
Ball 60
he's
feet in
the
air.
The
he's doing
time.
Headers. He's kicking the ball. He's doing chest bumps with the basketball to try to get alley-oops with guys. And against the Heat, he was doing the same thing. And then he came out and scored 13 points in 8 minutes, just absolutely effortlessly against a team that's second best in defensive rating over the last month.
Real quick on Kyrie. Way to get that in there, Jeremy. Yeah. Real quick on Kyrie. He is so skilled. You know what? Never mind. Keep
all
going.
Right. Perfect. I have something. me and Stugatz have been talking back-channeling that these guys never saw Pistol Pete.
Nope.
Okay?
Pistol Pete basically had a string on the ball on his hand.
You did see
so much more. Listen, so much more so than everybody else.
Yep.
That his dad, who was his coach, by the way, Dan, mm-hmm. I don't know if you're paying attention. Mm-hmm. His dad would drive the car, and Pistol Pete would dribble the ball outside the door, going 20 miles an hour.
Amazing.
Stop. Nobody can do that.
Nope.
I did not have you schooling us, Tony, with Pistol Pete's ball handling, which I felt like he used both hands to dribble and was wearing a belt. He was wearing a
He did it while his dad was driving the car.
His shorts had a belt on them. You did not hear me incorrectly earlier in the show. Wembanyama had 17 points in 3 minutes. In three basketball minutes.
Seems impossible.
That's a thing that happened. And as many people are pointing out, this is the worst version of him. The only hope that the league has is that somehow that body, which is awfully flexible, but bodies like that have a history of breaking down, that body can't withstand what it's going to be asked to withstand. This is from Bomani Jones, Stugatz, who, like a lot of people, had an opinion on you turning down the WFAN job. Have you heard about this? Have you said that?
I have not, no.
You don't know anything about this?
No, I stay off social media, Dan.
All right.
Bad things there.
Bomani writes, I truly love Stugatz. He's a better dude than most would understand, but I cannot stop laughing at the idea of putting him in charge.
I see it as a good idea. I don't know what you guys are thinking.
I don't know why I'm laughing.
Harsh.
Yeah, a little harsh. I mean, when I was in charge, I kind of hired Bomani at $7.90 the ticket. I mean, I don't know, didn't I?
You did not?
You
he was doing a weekly show with us. I mean, I love Bomani. I never questioned his talent. Why is he questioning my talent? My ability to lead. My ability to be in charge.
Stu's never better than when he's in charge.
I'm offended.
Give him the reins. Yes. He can run it.
Ask Joel what he thinks about that.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Bankrupted Joel? I don't think you hired Bomani.
Well, I mean, Bomani is a fantastic talent. He sent me a demo tape of his doing a radio show. I thought he was great. We had him down at the station a few times. He started doing weekly stuff with us, and he's fantastic. I have nothing bad to say about Bomani. I'm not going to be dragged into this, okay?
Whoa, whoa.
If he doesn't think I'd be a good PD, he is entitled to his opinion. I think he is a fantastic host.
You just took credit for Bomani, and I don't
I'm
think
not taking
that that's
credit
factual.
For
I don't
you said
think,
you hired him.
I don't think Bomani was...
I can't really, you know, the details are foggy. I mean...
He just dropped a diss track and said, but let me step away from this.
How did you find Bomani just out of curiosity when you hired him?
I think he sent me some tapes. I think it was actually Jason Whitlock who introduced us. I believe that was the connection point right there.
Oh.
Yeah. Remember him?
I don't have that recall of events, but we are you're Jay Cole-ing out of the situation. You're saying
I'm not going to beef with Bomani Jones. It's an unwinnable beef. He's the greatest beefer of all time.
But it doesn't have to be a beef. It does. It's just I'm just reading to you what he said. He truly loves you. The first half of that, he's a better dude than most would understand. Like the idea.
Well, that's Sal Licata right before he's about to slam you over the head. I mean, seriously.
A little backhanded.
It's the Stugatz move, though. I love this guy, but finish.
Using the Stugatz move on Stugatz.
Yeah, he learned it from me. I discovered him. I mean, taught him everything he knows.
You know, Pistol Pete would dribble around his house blindfolded.
You were saying in the last segment, you made it 20 miles an hour. Man, Stugatz said, Stugatz told you during the break, come on, Tony, quit being an amateur. Make it 70 miles an hour. Make it
express lane.
Make it Pistol Pete is in the Sun Pass lane going 75 miles an hour. dribbling it underneath the floorboard of the car and going...
I don't understand.
Between the legs.
Between the legs.
Between the cars.
Between the car.
I don't understand why Tony did the thing where it's like you guys never saw him. It's like as if Tony isn't like 32.
I went back as a basketball savant myself, just like Kyrie Irving. I went back into the annals of time
We've
and saw
seen
things
Pistol
like this.
Pete clips, Tony.
No, not like
yes,
this.
Yes, we have.
He listen to this, guys. One night during a violent thunderstorm, he climbed out of his bedroom window and dribbled through mud puddles. You can tell me Kyrie Irving did that.
Did they even have gravel back then?
Find everything.
Case closed.
Mud puddle.
Find everything you can find on the legend.
He didn't pave the roads yet.
Of Pistol Pete.
When a friend bet him he couldn't keep the ball spinning continuously for an hour, Pete spun the skin off his fingertips, knuckles, thumbs, and collected $5.
He's the Chuck Norris of the NBA.
At the end of spinning the ball on his finger, it was just a human skeleton because all of his skin had unraveled and fallen on the floor at Pistol Pete's feet.
You'd see that if you watched the tape. He didn't actually have a finger. It was just a bone.
Tony was at that game with his grandfather watching Pistol Pete dribble until the skin came off his body, and he was just a skeleton.
Trying to put you guys on game, man.
Scoring 45 points.
Well done.
Caitlin Clark broke his record.
Can you? Yes, but she played more games.
And no three-point line either.
And threes.
Don't forget the three-point line.
Yeah,
but don't be careful. People
do it in a car.
For saying that.
Do it in a 70-mile-an-hour car.
Well, here's the thing. We don't know about the speed. So it says, as his father drove the family car at varying speeds, we don't know yet, Pete would hang out the window and dribble.
Wow.
Dan, have you ever put the ball outside of a car?
Yes, I have done that.
How'd it work?
But I was going 4 or 5 miles an hour with my father driving. Like,
right. So you knew the legend of Pistol Pete. Well,
I had to break the window open.
No, I had to make him stop the car, and I had to go get it out of somebody's yard.
So you hit the rock, it would bounce off a rock.
That would never happen to Pete.
No, it would not, because he would just dribble it from one window, and he would grab it in the other, and he would just dribble it between the tires. He would cross over other cars. You'd see other cars.
Swerving right, back to the left.
Their wheels would be spinning. They'd be on their roof.
Touched earth.
Is this why people drive so down here? They're all trying to dribble basketballs.
Find me more Pistol Pete information, Tony. Right. And if you would video, just feel free to find, wherever you can, black and white video of 1950s basketball so you can see in general the way people were dribbling, which is both hands in front of them and chest passes. Everything was a fundamental chest pass. And out there, Pistol Pete was making him crazy by spinning a ball on his finger during timeouts until his skin came off. Do you realize how outraged the announcers were in the 1950s at Pistol Pete's showmanship? They were so pissed off.
We have to take another break for blood because Pistol Pete keeps spinning his finger.
Tony knows he was there.
He also played 1970 to 1980, so that's a fine.
Yeah. Okay, I'm sorry.
Off by a couple of decades.
My bad. I associate early 50s, 60s basketball
it's
with
fair.
Black
yes.
and white, and you're right. 70s basketball is when it went when the television sets became more.
Well, slow-mo wasn't invented until 1999.
After retiring in 1980 on the roof of his home, he painted a large message for passing UFOs, volunteering himself for capture.
Well, that's handle.
That has nothing to do with handle.
That's just something that...
Just a legend.
Adding color to it.
It sounds
color
like
to
one
his.
Of the things that he had a handle on was not sanity.
Sounds like something John Stockton would do.
Like, what are you talking about?
I'm still wondering what it is he wanted to say about Kyrie.
So am I. Think
fine,
that,
I'll say it. I think dribbling is his second best skill. He's a better finisher than a dribbler. Boom.
And so what happened? You were just scared of it earlier?
Didn't want to change the topic. Yeah. We only had less than a minute left, and Tony still had something. I was like, you go. I'm really good at this.
Yeah. Executive producer Billy also doesn't realize that your pause and forgetting your thought was edited out of the show.
By the time Pistol Pete was 7 years old, he was giving his father suggestions on coaching Press's college team.
Huh.
The dad, Press Maravich, by the way, great names.
Handles.
And you were there.
I don't know if Stugatz would have any interest in this movie, but I've been telling you for a while that A24 as a studio seems to be making better things than most people. Seems to have an association as a studio that you don't often get, where people are just trusting that if they spend money somewhere, it'll be worth watching. And Alex Garland's Civil War opened at $25.7 million over the weekend. It was a record for A24. They also spent more money than they usually spent, because that used to be, before the success, something of a smaller house. But Civil War is based on where it is we seem to be headed in 2024. I guess some people want to see what that might look like in the modern incarnation as we live it. And I, more than any other studio, I've told you, Stugatz, right now, that I trust A24 to make good things. So I imagine if a lot of people, I don't know, I don't think that's going to have, after the sun sets, Rotten Tomato ratings of 18 and 52. I'm guessing that the ratings on that one are really strong. If the word of mouth is strong and it's also opened strong. Something I wanted to discuss with you, though, and the group, because I know that Billy has grown. I don't know whether this has happened since having kids or it's been an always thing, but he has grown tired of driving in general, and driving in South Florida, you have heard me say, is a bit of a nightmare these days because we're overcrowded. I don't know if you saw what happened on the Rickenbacker Causeway, Key Biscayne. There's only one way in, one way out. And there are a number of places like this in South Florida that if a big tree falls over in a hurricane, people aren't going to be able to get out of where it is that they are. And so there was 5 hours and 6 hours of traffic just to get off of Key Biscayne this this weekend, and the driving down here in South Florida is just always been an apocalypse, but it's more of an apocalypse than it's been at any time that I can remember.
In the Rickenbacker Causeway situation, it's kind of like a perfect storm of people not reading that there's going to be road closures, but then also doing a road closure at a terrible time.
Yeah.
There's that, but how about just the general idea? Billy made some sort of whimpering noise that is hard to discern. You disagree with my assessment that you're not a big fan of driving?
I mean, I guess it's a fair assessment. Jess and I were speaking, and we both said if I was super rich, I'd have a driver because I don't want to drive anymore, which seems like not a crazy thing to want to just have a driver.
Oh, wow. I don't make much of a distinction between being the one driving in traffic and sitting in traffic in a passenger
seat.
Totally
different. And if you have a driver, if you're sitting in the back and you have a driver, stretch out your legs, you're fine. My driver would drive a minivan. I would sit in the back of a minivan, I think.
Bench seat, though, or a captain seat?
No, captain's chair all the way. Yeah,
yeah,
captain's
and you can
chairs.
Lean it back.
Exactly, right. And then if you want to guest, they have the same luxuries that you have. I don't know about those fancy cars with the doors that open the other way, and then they have like stars on the roof.
What do you not know about a Rolls Royce, Billy? That you don't think it's good enough?
I'm saying I don't think that's necessary. I'm fine in a Dodge Voyager or whatever. That's good enough for me.
But it's the act of driving. It's not being in the traffic.
Oh, no doubt. The act of driving is the stressful part of the equation.
Yeah, I mean, I'm definitely still going to have to get from point A to point B, right? I'd rather someone else be doing the driving while I'm getting from point A to point B.
You've never been in the back of an Uber annoyed because you're in traffic, even though you're not driving?
Yeah, but if I was driving, I'd be more annoyed, I think.
Driving's terrible.
Wait, hold on.
Billy.
I think this is a control issue now, is what I think is going on here. You guys want to be in control, so you want to drive.
Yes.
If you're like, I'm going to have to get there anyways. Because, Jeremy doesn't drive, not to put his business out there, but he'll take the bus or the train every once in a while. I feel like if I'm taking the train, I have time to do other things. If I'm not driving, I can go on my laptop.
It's incredible.
I can research some stuff. I can watch some
highlights.
No, train
is. I understand the train being a relief to being in traffic. What I'm not making a distinction between is being in the back seat, passenger seat, or driver's seat in this traffic. It's all unpleasant to me. I suppose it's degrees of unpleasant, but not by much.
We were also making the distinction about celebrities who get themselves into trouble by getting into accidents, doing, dangerous driving. But I agree with Billy just in general. Just driving, especially here, is so stressful that sometimes when you get out of the car, you feel like you need to just, do something to just wash the stress off.
Yeah, decompress
because,
a little.
I mean, it is so terrifying driving. I purposely don't do things. Lucy invited me to go to a concert with her a few weeks ago in Fort Lauderdale, and I was like, absolutely not. There's no chance. And she would have driven, but I don't want to be in a car on 95 ever.
But a permanent driver seems, at least for Billy, it seems like it would be a problem. Because you like to stop at a lot of places. You're going to have that person.
Where do I stop?
I mean, you're stopping at Burger King. You got to go to Walgreens because you're a hypochondriac. There's a lot of stops that you don't necessarily want to get out of a Walgreens parking lot, in a big SUV.
You're at a supermarket every single day of your life.
That's not true.
Yes, it is. I always hear you saying, I got to go to Target. I got to go to Walmart. I got to go here. I got to go there.
Yeah, it's an easy lie. It's like my kid has to do this. That's not true.
Finally got you.
I do love a good Target run, though. Oh, I'll stroll around Target forever if I have to. Right. However, I also love the mobile Target orders. I just turned into a commercial for Target. I love the mobile Target orders where I will do all of my shopping and then I just go and then they bring it to my car and then they tell me they can't take a tip even though I offer them a tip because of the rules. Guess what, kids? No one's watching.
I'm still so on those. Because really? I need to make sure that everything that I bought is in those bags. And then I have to sit there in the back, like, ruffling through everything.
Yeah,
like,
I trust them.
Did they remember the third bar of soap that I asked for?
I trust them, but one time I found that they didn't put this makeup sponge that my wife ordered. And it was a devastating discovery because I discovered how much makeup sponges cost.
I was horrified at the idea
that this little sponge that's like tear shaped that this size was like $24. And I'm like, why?
And then you get home and your wife is pissed.
Beauty blender.
No, I got down. No, I discovered it. I started going through and I'm like, because I never ask. I usually just go and trust that it's all there. And for whatever reason, they handed me like two bags and I'm like, That's all that was ordered? Like, this seemed, and I found out it wasn't there, and I was like, whoa, how much did this cost? And then I had to go in, and they had to bring, so it was a whole thing.
I feel like I've done the same typecasting to you that Stugatz has done, which is I do picture that if you had a driver, mm-hmm. there would be a lot of stops for just, like, Vicks vapor rub.
Yeah, right. But them's the brakes. That's part of being a driver. You know what I mean? Like, the person's going to get paid the same whether we stop or don't stop. What do you want me to do?
But I'm just saying that I've got you outside the Target, and they're bringing it to your car just a little Vicks vapor rub, and you're trying to give them a dollar because your chest was a little congested and you wanted a little heat on it. That is how I picture that going.
I mean, I'm insulted that you guys think that I would be in a car without Vicks vapor rub, to be perfectly honest with you. Like, that's already in the backpack. Not going to happen, that scenario. It's fantasy
land. Who wouldn't want to get driven around everywhere? I'm not understanding this.
I like driving.
This is great. I thought everyone...
No one likes driving. And you know how
I like driving.
No, I can tell you why you don't like driving.
Because I don't drive to work?
No. Well, I didn't even think about that. You know why you don't like driving? Back in the day, on Sundays, people just used to go out for drives. Yeah. I just want to drive my old Cadillac, whatever the hell, long thing with the long front and the back with the fins of the, you know what I mean?
That's little Sunday drive.
Exactly right. Yeah. No one does that anymore. No one drives just to drive, dude. And if they do, they're psychopaths.
Your own personal back in my day. So there's somebody in the America that you've described, Pistol Pete's America,
Thank you. 1970s. Thank you.
When he's driving past, dribbling underneath his car, there are just people, imagine this, internet addicted people, just standing in their lawn. That was a Sunday afternoon. Yeah. That was a Sunday afternoon. Wait a minute. There's nothing on the three channels I have. I don't have a computer. My phone is not my computer. I've got a landline ringing inside. What am I doing? I'm standing on my lawn on a Sunday afternoon.
Delightful, though.
I've gone into the backyard.
Hosing the grass for no reason.
The time
you didn't have to worry about droughts or anything. You just hose the grass as much as you wanted.
And there was definitely no chemical in that water or in the fertilizer you were using that would soon be banned.
Hmm. Norm MacDonald did such a great bit on how your grandfather just had like one picture taken of him when he was irritated by somebody who was like using gunpowder and hiding under a curtain and would have no idea now that in your phone you have 1,000 pictures.
That's part of why I'd rather be driven around, because then I can look at my phone. Think about all the time spent in traffic where I can't look at my phone.
It makes me dizzy. I can't do it.
Really? You guys can't look at your phone?
Reading too much in the car?
Close my eyes and put the seat back.
Put it on the poll at Lebatard Show. Do you get dizzy reading your phone in your car?
I get dizzy reading.
You know what I saw the other day driving around? A Cybertruck.
Wow.
In the wild.
Billy, I have seen like 5 of these in the last weekend. Like, there are a lot of Cybertrucks in Miami, and they were all different ones, too. Like, I think I just saw 3 alone yesterday.
I was excited to see it because it was my first time seeing it. I felt like, I don't know, like a little kid going to the zoo or something, or for the first time seeing an elephant or whatever. It's massive, but as I'm watching, I'm like, this is totally impractical if you actually want a pickup truck. Like, this would not do the duties of a real pickup truck.
You've got to forgive me. I have no idea what a Cybertruck is.
The Tesla truck.
There's no way you don't know what a Cybertruck is.
Imagine a five-year-old. You asked a five-year-old to draw you a truck from the future.
But they can only
use
writing.
That's exactly what this is.
And it cuts off your fingers.
Okay. Yeah. What?
Allegedly, we don't know that.
No, that's true.
What do you mean?
It has the capabilities of cutting off your fingers.
Like, if you open the hood and it falls on your finger, apparently people think that it is strong enough to just slice your finger off. Other cars have, like, safety mechanisms, apparently.
Not a problem for Pistol Pete.
I don't know.
Well, he only had bones.
And this is a Tesla?
Yes. Yeah, this is a Tesla
Cybertruck.
So it's
an electric truck.
Fully electric. Bulletproof windows. Unless you throw something at it, then they break.
Yeah. It is so pointy. It is the pointiest, sharpest car I've ever seen. Yeah. In my life.
And it rusts. That's another issue that they found, is because of the metal, I guess, being untreated or whatever, it rusts.
Do you guys, because I feel...
Other than that, it's great.
I feel all the time, like I'm living in the age of the Jetsons. I feel the ability to have illegal mezcal sent to my house by some random stranger who just shows up 10 minutes after I've ordered it makes me feel like I'm living the movies that used to depict our future. We're presently living in the convenience of what would have been the futuristic time as we imagined it in the 70s, 80s, and 90s.
Didn't the Jetsons predict, oops, sorry about that. Didn't the Jetsons predict Zoom meetings? Weren't they just talking to each other on screens?
Is it everything you dreamed of, Dan? I mean, it's...
It's what not, the hell did you have ordered to your house?
It's not at all.
I wouldn't admit it on air.
Adina Menzel?
Jose Cuervo.
Yeah, Jose.
Just Cuervo now.
Cuervo Club Fridays. Cuervo.
That's what I meant.
Yeah.
MMA Hangout sponsored by Cuervo, by the way. That's incredible fights. I know, Dan, you're going to give me the next 30 seconds to talk about the fights. Incredible fights, the biggest card ever on the planet for UFC. We had two incredible knockouts. One, Justin Gaethje and Max Holloway in a phone booth fight, Dan. Max was winning the entire fight, said, come to the center of the ring. We're both going to fight it out. And then an incredible last buzzer beater second knockout from Max Holloway to Justin Gaethje. Knocks him out, wins the BMF title. In the second one, Alex Pereira knocks out Sweet Dreams Jamal Hill and then points at him, does one of these. Izzy, I feel like there was a lot of stuff left on the bone there from the Kendrick, Drake, J. Cole, now enter Rick Ross, basically the entire hip-hop community having beef with each other. What are the things that stood out to you? Like, do you want to go back into the original one? Is there stuff on the back end from Drake, Rick Ross? Like, what's the most interesting point to you?
The most interesting part to me is, like, sort of where all these beefs started happening. Because one minute, I think Drake and Future are friends. I think Drake and Rick Ross have been making, you know, songs for years. How could they be enemies at this point? And then they sort of unleash all the details. And then they also say, hey, there's more to come. And it's almost like, you know, if you're in hip hop, you are basically just collecting information. Mm-hmm. If you are any good, you know, at some point you're going to have some secrets on people. And so that is, to me, the most interesting. And then you throw in the dynamic of J. Cole not wanting any part of that.
Right.
Like, J. Cole's diss track was, hey, I'm better than you. Your discography, that's what that was called, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is not as good as you think. And if you really want to mess with me, well, I mean, I guess technically he threatened to kill him. But if you really want to mess with me, I will take you down.
Somebody else would kill him.
Right. And so I think that, to me, it's like they're talking two different concepts here, right? So J. Cole and Kendrick are talking the hardest MC, the most respected, which is why Kendrick said money, power, respect, the last one is better. Mm-hmm. Right? You can take all your money and power, Drake. He was almost like preemptively saying, I know what you're going to say. That doesn't matter to me. The respect is better. Where Drake is saying, look, I have, there's no way you can argue with what I brought to the table. My entire discography, everything that I've done is amazing, and I'm selling out, you know, spots in foreign lands, and you guys aren't doing that. And I also have some dirt on you guys. Whereas, again, J. Cole and Kendrick are like, hey, we're just better at this than you. And so that doesn't always translate to dollars. You're good at one thing. We're good at this other thing. And so to me, it's like the guys at the top of the game are having different arguments. But I don't care. I'm just here for all of it. I want the drama part. I want the details of, you know, who had what plastic surgery and mm-hmm. who's not claiming what child.
Whose, like, baby all that mama's doing what.
Me. Yeah.
I think the interesting part, too, that you mentioned is Drake is so high and above everybody else when it comes to all those things you mentioned, right? Like, just social capital. He's mm-hmm. at the top of the heap, more hits than the Beatles. Like, we know who Drake is.
He can have a bomb album, like a bomb, like a dud, and it doesn't really matter. Doesn't
He's had them, and they haven't affected him.
Right.
Right? Like, think about the last time you had a classic Drake album. There's a lot of them that have a lot of misses in them. But when you look at the fight, right, it almost feels like when a rich guy gets into a fight and he's like, I don't really care. Like, I'm rich. It doesn't mm-hmm. really matter to me. Like, remember LeBron with the media was like, I'm going to go back to my mansion and, like,
right.
whatever. It doesn't really matter. That's almost like it feels like what Drake's coming from. He's like, guys, you see where I live. You see what I do. You see my 757 plane. Like, it doesn't really matter to me. You guys can figure out your petty beast by yourselves. But then everybody else is coming in with just with real stuff, it yeah. feels like.
Yeah, and then, you know, Drake is texting his mom is texting Drake saying, hey, the internet says you got a nose job. We should have gotten a 2-for-1 if that was the case. And he's like, no, that's just this guy I used to rap with. He's gone crazy. He's a little racist. We'll handle it. And the we'll handle it part all of a sudden became like a threat. Like, he's just going to. And that, to me, is just the interesting part is, when does this go too far? Like, I'm here for all the drama.
Is nose job too far?
No, no.
Is fake abs too far?
Not too far.
Is white boy too far?
How many times did he say it?
14.
It's a little bit too far. I actually, you know, I thought the initial...
For those that don't know, Rick Ross came out with a diss track against Drake, called him white boy like 14 different times within the song.
Yeah, and yeah, so I just think the personal part of it, if it goes too far, it's only going too far if you're actually threatening violence, and it's going to happen. It's a Tupac Biggie situation. Like, if you get that far, it's clearly too far. But I just don't think that's where this is going. It's just why I liked the Drake diss, because, again, it was more details. Hey, I know this. Hey, Kendrick, you've been talking about this diss track for 4 years now. You say you know things. Drop it already, because I'm ready to respond. That to me, is great. And I think of this all like, I don't want the violence, right? I don't want anything happening to them. Mm-hmm. And so when you boil it all down, it just kind of makes me laugh. It's like when guys are mad at each other, what are we going to do? Write poems about each other, right? And then just put it to
hold music. Me back.
Yeah. Back in the day, we used to have duels. Now right. We write poetry.
You would slap somebody with a glove.
Right.
Tony, you said Drake has a 747 still, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Do we know if it's a Boeing? It's a Boeing. So
I don't know if it's a Boeing,
actually. That
could
be diss track worthy.
Right.
Like, oh, your plane is so bad that the parts are coming up because the manufacturer skimped out on
labor. Spit those bars, Jess.
Wow, that would be an incredible.
The union wasn't strong, and your plane is actually probably due for maintenance now.
Ouch.
That's what I would do if I wrote a diss track about Drake.
I mean, jeez.
You better watch your back, Jess.
Yeah.
By the way, all these people who are giving us a hard time about not knowing anything about the Allen Iverson statue, can we clarify that we do know about the Allen Iverson statue? Yeah. Because Jess, you told us that they are all small. Miniature.
Apparently the ones in their practice facility are all small, but that doesn't change the fact that this is a tiny statue. So okay. I don't yell at me about the statue. I saw what I saw. It's a tiny statue. Yeah.
Don't
and
unveil
it's funny.
A statuette and call it a statue and
you
not
expect
to
be taller
jokes.
Than the statue itself.
Right.
Right. Because when he's like looking down at the statue, almost like taking off the little cover.
It's like the jokes are still relevant. I don't care what the truth is.
Exactly.
Who do you have in the beef?
Whew. I honestly think Kendrick has played it the best. I think Kendrick started the
first
fire.
Shot. Yeah.
He took the first shot. He had the most memorable line. It was the surprise element of it all because nobody knew it was coming. I think the fact that it was with Future and Metro on that album, mm-hmm. We Still Don't Trust You, all that stuff made it feel just legit and everybody else reacting. And the reaction being, oh, what is this? 20 against 1? Oh, you came with extensions. I don't care. That verse was fire.
Was.
And the best thing about these types of beefs is when you can just nail the beef on a banger.
Yeah.
And like that absolutely did that. Like, you listen to that song over and over again, you have to remind yourself. I have to remind myself that Future is dissing him. It was like, oh, guys from the bottom are really like that. It's
right.
Like, oh, wow. That's a Drake reference and all this stuff. So it's all crazy fun to me. My concern is just don't go over the top and get crazy. I think the line is right where Rick Ross is right now. He is sitting mm-hmm. on that line.
White boy's the line.
Poor line.